The quest for Super Bowl 34 begins today.
Time to go to work, baby. Time to go to work.
All right, let's go, guys. Let's go.
In an NFC Championship rematch, Randall and 3D lead the Vikes on a revenge tour in the land of the Dirty Birds. The Jets were one step away from the Super Bowl last year. Can Vinny take Parcells to the promised land for a fourth time? Southpaw quarterbacks, we'll tell you why they're a little bit left of center.
I'm not quirky like a kicker, but I mean, I have my quirks.
Two of the best go head-to-head in Jacksonville. Favre looks to make one more legendary run, this time on his own. While the Seahawks now have a legend in the making, and the Lions try to replace one. Coaches in stretch.
I think we became a team today. We became a team.
How do they cope? Who will have a better debut, Ricky or Edgerrin?
They cannot stop me right now.
Who will be the beast of the East? Troy and the boys go to Washington, where the Skins want to win with their new champ.
Ooh, 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 ooh.
The Browns are back. The rebirth of a rivalry begins fittingly with the Steelers. Can Doug be the Magic Flutie again this season? We answer all the questions next on a whole new season of Sunday NFL Countdown.
Football League. For the 13th season, ESPN brings it to you hook, line, and sinker. Sunday Night Football, preceded by primetime, but the day truly begins with the gang of merry men and women that we call Sunday NFL Countdown. Hello once again, everybody. I'm Dick Vitale, and welcome to the final NFL season of the decade, the century. Heck, make it the millennium. In 2 hours every Sunday, we get you set for kickoff and then some. But you know that already. You also know this gentleman at my side for every one of those 13 years? We're either the Tom Jackson. We're either the Huntley Brinkley or Laurel and Hardy of football. I'm
Huntley,
not sure.
Huntley Brinkley.
Welcome back. Well, you certainly know this fellow. Speaking of wild rides, nobody circles the wagons like James Kelly.
That's right.
Welcome back.
Thanks, boss.
Nice box, bro.
Okay.
And then let me be the first ever to wish you a happy new year, Sterling.
You know,
record-setting wide receiver for the Green Bay Packers, Sterling Sharp. Welcome back.
Thank you.
The Sharp that speaks.
Yes.
Well, not too much.
Okay, I'll keep it down.
Yeah, right.
And the guy with more scoops than Baskin Robbins. He's inside the huddle. He may be inside your garage. Chris Mortensen. Mortimer, welcome.
Great to be here. Just glad that Tommy's not going to be tackling me today anytime. The Bristol campus off limits.
Don't give them a preview. Now, we welcome to the show for the first time, but not new to any of our NFL shows by any means, Stuart Scott, where this year all the games are Stu games.
If I'm not a rookie, that means I don't have to carry the bags, right?
Yeah, you're fine, but sing the fight song later on, please. And joining our ESPN team after spending the 80s and the 90s as one of the most successful head coaches. Cleveland Browns, and for the past decade of the Kansas City Chiefs, you know what? I've thought about it. He was the coach.
Hey, Dave! Hey, Bill!
Marty Schottenheimer is with us. Welcome, coach.
Thank you. I finally got it right the second time.
Indeed, we'll have a quiz on these names later on. Marty's a frequent visitor to this show, which will be enlightened, and to all our NFL shows. Welcome aboard, and great, you don't care who wins or loses.
I'll be undefeated at the end of the day.
Isn't that very nice? Joe Theismann, of course, will join us weekly, as he always had. He's in Cleveland tonight for the historic opener. There's a lot to jump about in this 1999 season. We head out to the stadiums. We welcome back an old friend, but I mean that figuratively, certainly not literally. Come on back, Susie Culber.
Thanks, Chris. It's great to be back. As for this one, Patriots-Jets, enough said. Although I guess I could add that Bill Parcells is going for his fourth straight win against his old team. Something not lost on Pete Carroll.
Here in Jacksonville, an interconference matchup with a playoff atmosphere. The Jags and the 49ers are hoping to play the very first game and very last game against each other.
At a sold-out Georgia Dome, it's a rematch of the biggest upset in NFC Championship game history. Once again, the Vikings are favored to beat the Falcons, who are playing up the lack of respect theme.
It's a new day in Green Bay as the Packers move beyond Mike Holmgren into the Ray Rhodes era. What will the Packers do on offense, and what will the dominant Raider defense do to stop them?
Now
Cowboys owner Jerry Jones told me, quote, it doesn't look good for Deion Sanders playing today for Dallas, but he will come out and test his toe at the stadium in just a little while and then make a final decision.
In Indianapolis, Edgerrin James takes his place alongside Peyton Manning as the Colts try to return to respectability, while Doug Flutie tries to continue the magic that led the Bills to the playoffs last season.
Ricky Williams will play today against the Carolina Panthers. The Saints hope their only draft pick can help lead them to their first winning season since 1992 and become New Orleans' first 1,000-yard rusher since 1989. Back to you, Chris.
All right, Melissa, thank you. Thanks, everybody. Back to all the stadiums shortly. We're going to party like it's 1999. An NFL kickoff weekend, 99. Huge season with a huge influx of big-name skill player rookies. Five quarterbacks picked in the first round, including Tim Couch, Donovan McNabb, Akili Smith, 1, 2, 3. The running backs who won 4 or 5, Edgerrin James, and the much ballyhooed Ricky Williams. The Denver Broncos trying to do what no other team has done, win 3 straight Super Bowls. Tom, 6 others have tried and failed. Okay, so there's no John Elway, but there is 2,000-yard man Terrell Davis. Okay, there's no Reggie White. Alas, no Barry Sanders. But there's unbridled excitement around the league. What should be a wide-open season, complete with replay, is a bye every week, which means for week one, the Chargers remain undefeated. And here come the Cleveland Browns, one of the NFL's most storied franchises, back after a 3-year hiatus. Back 50 seasons after Automatic Otto Graham, Lou the Toe Groza and company led them to a title in their first NFL campaign. Spitting, they opened their new era against their oldest rival, the Pittsburgh Steelers. Stu, you were there in 1950, weren't you? You remember that.
I wasn't there, but that fat guy with the dog mask was there, and now he's in our commercial, so it all comes full circle. Boomer's been 1,358 days since a team in Cleveland, an NFL team, strapped on shoulder pads. Marty, interesting drama. Their first game against Bill Cowher, former linebacker for the Browns, coached in Cleveland under you. Now, he says it might be a different stadium, but it'll be the same as always, loud and rowdy.
Stuart, the dreams of the Browns' return has finally been realized. I've stood in front of that crowd down there and literally had the hair in my arms stand up. The place is going to be electric.
Former Brown, current Brown, DB Antonio Langham says it's Cleveland football again. He has this wild, almost detached look. It means your blood starts to bleed brown again. And bleeding brown, an interesting phenomenon because it's an expansion team that has to live up to a legacy. Our Solomon Wilcox is hanging out with some brown bleeders at the NFL Experience in Cleveland 9 hours before game time. Sal?
Yeah, Stuart, the Cleveland Browns, well, you know what? It's been really exciting here in Cleveland all weekend long. They've been celebrating, and of course, the fans here are anticipating their beloved Browns taking the field after a 3-year hiatus. I was at that game 3 years ago at the old historic Cleveland Browns Stadium back on December 17, 1995. It was a cold and somber day, but today there's nothing but sunshine and smiles here on the banks of Lake Erie. Now, they've been celebrating in Cleveland all weekend long, and in a very big way, the band Little Beat provided the views for the big dogs who were out enjoying themselves. While the NFL Experience, well, they brought out the little dogs, and maybe this is a sign of things to come. Tim Couch versus Cordell Stewart. Of course, the pressure was on Tim Couch early, but Cordell Stewart emerges as the winner. And, of course, everyone's fan favorite, former Cleveland Browns quarterback Bernie Kosar, delighted the fans by signing autographs. They tried to talk to him coming out of retirement, but he declined. Now, as you can see, Stewart, the fans here really know how to have a good time, but they also know how to intimidate their fans. And, Tommy, you're a native of Cleveland. You know better than anyone the depth of love the fans here have for their football team.
Well, Solomon, I used to be one of those fans, and it wasn't called the dog pound then, but it is the best fan base in the country, with all due respect to all the other NFL fans around the country. And the expectations for this team will be a little bit higher. But when you think about this ball club, out of their 22 starters, 17 of them have playoff experience, 9 on the defensive side of the ball. So when Carmen Policy and Dwight Clark put this ball club together, I think they put it together with the knowledge that we want to be in football games and give our offense a chance in the fourth quarter to have a chance to win.
They've done this before.
Yes, they know a little bit about Winnie from San
Francisco. Which means what, I got to pitch them now? I'm just telling you one thing. November 7th. Okay, one home game against Baltimore. If they win that game, the whole season will be a success, 1-15.
Who won't be there?
Well, the good thing is Art and David Modell probably won't be using their seats. We can go.
Yeah.
we can go. Well, let's go to the season here, guys, because last year, I mean, Minnesota, not even in the Super Bowl, but 556 points. An offense, well, it was record-setting. So
imitation is the highest form of flattery. Does everybody kind of play Viking-style offense? Can they?
I think so. I think what you're going to see a lot more of is three wide receivers, and they're trying to flip the football field, and that is throw the long pass to try and get field position. Instead of going 17, 18 play drives, they want to go two, three, four play drives and try and get scores quickly.
Well, the NFL would love that, Sterling. I mean, this is a league that does not want defenses or kickers to dominate. That's why you saw a rule change in the offseason where kickers don't get to use their own footballs. They got to use the league's footballs, Jim. It's all about offense. You quarterbacks like that, don't you?
Yeah, you do. But last year, the backup quarterback was very instrumental in the success of their teams. Good example, in Minnesota, when Brad Johnson went down, Randall Cunningham came in. When Rob Johnson went down, Doug Flutie came in. Bobby Brister came in for John Elway with the hamstring. And, of course, Glenn Foley goes down. Boom. Vinny Testaverde has a big, successful year, maybe an MVP year. Who are going to be the stars this year, Chris, in the backup role? Is it going to be maybe Jeff George, Rodney Peete? Maybe one of the
you almost don't want to start week one. Is that what you're saying?
Exactly.
It used to be, hey, I'm the starting quarterback. But you know what I think? I don't think anybody's going to go 15-1 two teams, Denver and Atlanta, 14-2. The Jets were, I think 12-4 might be the best.
Wide open. We shall see. They get you out. You got to bet right now. Ahead on NFL Countdown. We'll look at the pressure on the head coaches.
One of the most stressful things, the toll the job takes on their families. Our member of the quarterback class of 83 goes one-on-one.
It was a pivotal time for us in Minnesota. She looked up and said, Daddy, if we lose this game, does this mean we have to move? Now, when a seven-year-old reaches up and pulls your heart out like that, it makes you think long and hard about your profession.
Our member of the quarterback class of 83 goes one-on-one with the last alumnus still in the league. Who looks better? What does the commander-in-chief have in common with San Francisco's field general? You answer the question. And Morton Anderson entered the Vikings Super Bowl hopes. Will Dan Reeves be dancing after the rematch? We'll be back.
How did UPS become the official express delivery sponsor of the NFL? Just say they put us through a very challenging drill. For the earliest next day delivery, count on the same people the NFL does. UPS.
Kick off the NFL season today with DirecTV and Circuit City. When you buy a DirecTV system at Circuit City and subscribe to NFL Sunday Ticket and DirecTV's Total Choice Platinum programming, you'll score three free months of Total Choice Platinum and see DirecTV's official program guide, a savings of over $250. With NFL Sunday Ticket on DirecTV, you'll get over 200 regular season games. That's up to 13 games every Sunday. Save today at Circuit City.
Jiffy Lube Signature Service is all about. We put our name on the line every single day. It's our guarantee we did the job right. Jiffy Lube Signature Service. More than an oil change. And we offer quality Pennzoil and Quaker State products.
Hey, did you see my game-winning catch? Triple overtime. But with 1-800-CALL-ATT for collect calls, it's a low rate. No matter when I need to ride home.
Whoa! Hey, who do you see?
A low rate every minute everywhere. Dial 1-800-CALL-ATT.
Hey, working hard or hardly working? Steve Marino, hey, how's it going, fella?
Feeling hungry can affect your mood. That's why there's Balance Bar. It puts great taste, balanced nutrition, and sustained energy in the palm of...
Answers in every department. Low prices all over the store.
You know, it's not so long ago that we were speaking of this very game. Last January, the Atlanta Falcons, 11-point underdogs despite going 14-2, shocked the Minnesota Vikings in overtime 30-27 in Minneapolis, trailing by 2 points with 4 minutes to go in regulation. For the 15-1 Vikings who scored all those record-setting points, it was a head-scratcher of the first degree, and if they are hell-bent to prove that they can go the distance, then they have the perfect opener at Atlanta, where, oh, by the way, Super Bowl 34 will be played. But Southerners are real proud of their home cooking, aren't they? The Dirty Birds of Dan Reeves and Jamal Anderson, he of the over 1,800 yards and record 410 carries, Well, because they down south, they are fixing to make this a season-long party at the Georgia Dome. An NFC title rematch in week one. Shazam to Hotlanta. And our Andrea Kramer, good season, Andrea.
Good season to you, Chris. Well, the focus on the Falcons' offense has been the absence of wide receiver Tony Martin, the deep threat who loosened up defenses enough for Jamal Anderson to lead the conference in rushing. But Anderson wants to concentrate instead on who is returning, namely his lead blocker, who missed last year's championship game.
Bob Christian can do what for you?
A lot of things. See people that I don't see to chip people off of me.
Like
pick up
Robert
the safety.
Griffith?
Yeah, exactly. Pick up the safety. Picks up defensive linemen in certain places that I don't, you know, that you, I just can't account for.
Last season, Anderson accounted for nearly half of the Falcons' offense.
Can Jamal do even more this year?
I sure hope so. You know, hopefully less carries and more yards.
I'm going to try to have a couple more catches this year, and that would be nice. But 50% of the offense, I don't know. But it's a tremendous amount. If I'm asked to do it again and we can achieve the same results, I'll go 60% to get back to the Super Bowl.
For the Vikings to make it to the Super Bowl, they'll need a near-repeat performance from their record-setting offense of a year ago, which will have some subtle differences under new coordinator Ray Sherman.
This year is kind of, we're aggressive, but we're just a little more controlled. We were just going for it last year, and that's why we scored so many points.
Last year, one thing we did do is take away the deep threat, you know, the deep balls. And right now, if they can just nickel and dime down the football field and then actually have that advantage of airing it out also, then it'll make them a little bit more complete.
Randy Moss says we can put 50 or 60 up on anybody.
We don't care nothing about what Randy Moss says. He's going to have to go out there and prove it for his whole offense. He's speaking on behalf of his whole football team. Let him be the spokesperson.
Have enough confidence in his football team. We have enough faith in
Remember that Buchanan caused quite a stir when he showed up on Super Bowl media day wearing a studded dog collar. And Mark, he told me that he plans to make a similar fashion statement today when he will wear that dog collar during pregame warm-up.
Andrea, I'm not sure that Dan Reeves is going to go for that, because right now Dan Reeves feels like the entire psychological advantage has fallen his way. Hey, they're underdogs, they're at home, and they got plenty of bulletin board material from Randy Moss, even if they twisted it around.
Atlanta, 14-2 more. They win the division again? I mean, people still aren't sure.
Chris, I think the Falcons win the division easier than the Vikings try to defend their title. I think the Vikings may have to score 60 points in order to pull it off.
Well, I think the Vikings are certainly a weaker defense than they were last year when you consider the losses on that side of the football. And let's remember how Atlanta had success last year. It was a short, controlled passing game from Chris Chandler. Out of the 27 completions that he had in the championship game, 15 of them went to the tight end and the running back. And Dan Reeves assured me this week, we will throw the ball deep. It is the threat of the deep ball that opens things up underneath. So, Sterling, I don't think the deep ball left Atlanta with Tony Martin.
No, just the speed in which you throw the deep ball left Atlanta with Tony Martin. And getting Chris Callaway, what they got was a totally better route runner. Then they also got, courtesy of Mort to my left here, what they also got is a receiver that will block for Jamal Anderson, which may open up some of those longer runs. But you look at the league leader in the NFC was 19 yards per catch. Now you look at Chris Callaway comes in at 13-1. They're going to have to do some things in that offense to be able to create some field position. Kept four tight ends, which leads me to believe that they're going to do a lot more power running,
right,
throw a lot more to the tight ends down the middle of the football field.
Well, with him in Atlanta, we get to do a lot more. Hey. Which Dan Reeves likes that too. By the way, even though we're not on this game yet, we've just learned Ed Werder reports from Washington. No Deion today for the Cowboys against Washington. So we will update you on that game, but that we're just and we want you to have it right away. Because that's what we're all about here on Sunday NFL Countdown. Coming up next, replacing a Denver legend. While Bubby bobbled this preseason, Greasy stepped up, is ready to be a starter. And in New York, Philip Hotel rejuvenated the Jets. Can Keyshawn and company get to the big bowl?
Fine. Saturday on ESPN.
Gale State. Woo! Look at him go. Great, eh? Oh, he's the greatest of all time, Jack. Walter Payton. Sweetness, baby.
The greatest of the greatest of all time. No job.
Barry Sanders.
Barry Sanders.
No, Marcus Allen.
Greatest.com.
Hey, man, I really like the way he moves.
Yeah. Oh, she said Terrell Davis was a great one.
Well, that was yesterday, but today, Ricky Williams is the greatest of the greatest.
Oh, the greatest.
Emotional for sure. John Elway, you might have heard of him. 50,000 yards, 300 touchdown passes, and oh yes, two Super Bowl rings as he moved out the door. The door will be opened again to number 7 Monday night when at halftime of the Broncos Mile High game against Miami. He'll have his number retired. The NFL wishes they could retire the Broncos, the other teams that is. Two straight Super Bowls, last year's run at immortality when they went 13-0 before finally settling for that 14-2 mark. The man ahead of Elway on all those lists, except for the Super Bowl one, is Dan Marino. Is this his year now? The 10-6 Dolphins look the best they have under Jimmy Johnson. He started 245 times, including playoffs. Hall of Fame Dolphin quarterback Bob Greasy started 163 times, including playoffs. His son Brian Greasy starts for Denver. He started none.
I can sense the urgency in the locker room, putting in the game plan. Guys are studying more than they did last week, definitely, but it feels like a regular season game, and for me, it definitely will be my first start, and it's going to be fun.
Greasy and not the heir apparent Bubby Brisbane. Tommy, are you surprised here?
Yeah, I think everybody was surprised. Look, I think it translates into this. The chemistry of this football team is going to be a question mark until they start to win some games. Bubby Brister was a very popular guy, is a very popular guy on this ball club, won a quarter of the regular season games last year that eventually led to a Super Bowl championship. And then I think more importantly for Brian Greasy, the adjustment to game tempo, the game plan that he is going to see tomorrow night with every blitz package that Jimmy Johnson can think to bring at a young quarterback who hasn't really played. And I don't really know how he's going to respond to that.
I don't think anybody does, but I think it was unfair what they did to Bubby Brister. Of course, I'm not the head coach. But Bubby Brister proved last year that he can lead his team, leading to 4 victories. Preseason is exactly that. It's preseason. Very vanilla defenses. You're not going to see an overs, the unders, the blitzes from each side. Brian Greasy is in for a long road, but the thing about it is you can't overlook his number. 6 touchdowns and only 1 interception. And Marty, big question. Do you think Mike Shanahan is doing the right thing?
Jim, you know, a year ago in Kansas City, we had a situation where Bubby really beat us up pretty good. It's obvious, however, that Shanahan doesn't believe Bubby Brister can win as his starting quarterback. I think that's obviously the issue right here. When this thing unfolds in this season, it's all going to come down to one thing. Shanahan is in a position where few people have been, and that's an opportunity to three-peat. He's made his choice. It's obviously a bold choice. I think it's the right one.
You know what? When there's Denver information, I usually go to Tommy, but lately I've been talking with Shannon Sharp. And Shannon this week, you know, told me, well, he also said, but we'll have more of Shannon on Monday Night Countdown for 2 hours from 7 to 9 p.m. Mike Tirico gets to try to host a 2-hour pregame show. It's the best, though. Distant replay with some guy named Elway backstage with Tony Martin. Best of Monday Night Football. Tommy will be at Mile High Stadium to the hinterland. And then 9 o'clock Monday Night Football, ABC. Alan Boomer bringing you the Dolphins at the Broncos with the retirement ceremony at the half. It'll be great. New York and Boston are separated by just 200 miles. Culture, accent, and sports teams are separated by about 2,000 miles. There was always this nice AFL East rivalry in football between the Jets and the Patriots, but never has it reached the heights of the past 3 years as the 1996 Super Bowl coach of the Patriots, Billy Parcells, has turned the Gotham Green into Super Bowl contenders overnight. 2-5 at the Meadowlands, and Parcells' Jets have gone 3-1 in the previous 2 Bowls, including 24-14 and embarrassing 31-10 game last season. True, New England was Drew Bledsoe-less in that Meadowlands finale last year, but as they've gone from 11-5 to 10-6 to 9-7, Jets have gone from 1-15 to 9-7 to 12-4. On paper, this is not the opener that the always pessimistic New England fans would have wanted. The Jet fans thinking Super Bowl. To the swamps of Jersey and back to Susie Colbert. Susie?
Chris, you know I'm happy in the swamps of Jersey, and if there's any question that this game is still personal, earlier this week, Pete Carroll called it a grudge game. And how can you blame him? He was fired by the Jets after just one season, and he's still coaching in Bill Parcells' shadow in New England. And after losing three straight to Bill Parcells, he still refers to him as an icon. Pete Carroll desperately wants this New England team to be his team, so much so that he's working to reinvent himself.
Quite frankly, it's been It's been a tremendous offseason of introspection, of evaluation.
Result? He's more comfortable and confident, even though his Pats are picked to finish fourth, even fifth, in the AFC East.
That kind of dig what we're up against right now. So if you're seeing that, I hope you're seeing me at my best, you know, and what I best represent.
His team is a heavy underdog today, but the new Pete Carroll is still expecting a victory.
You know, when some people think, you know, how come you're not backing off? Are you afraid of this? I'm a little dangerous right now. I tell you, Frank, I'm a little dangerous right now.
Dangerous? That's Keyshawn Johnson with or without Wayne Corbett. He promises a much more physical approach this season. First test, co-MVP of the Pro Bowl, Patriots cornerback Ty Law.
We know all eyes are going to be on us at all times, and even if it's not, Keyshawn's going to bring a lot of attention to us anyway, you know, by talking or something.
You and Ty Law.
Ty Law? What about him?
He's going to do something to bring some attention to us, so I don't have to say a thing.
Good way to start the season. I mean, this is, let's get you right in there against one of the best.
Well, I see Aaron Glenn every single day in practice. Obviously, Ty Law is one of the top three, four corners in this entire league. At least his paycheck says so.
Well, money talks, but experience speaks for itself. The Patriots are counting on big performances from three rookies today. Andy Katzenmoyer says his right ankle feels fine. He gets to start at middle linebacker. Kevin Falk will start at running back and split some time with Terry Allen. And Damian Woody starts at center. This week, the Patriots coaches have thrown everything in the book at Woody, every formation that the Jets used over the last 2 years, because Woody has to make the blocking calls at the line. But more bottom line, the Patriots know to have a true winning season, they'll have to keep Terry Glenn healthy.
That's right, Susie. And I think the matchup you watch more than Ty Law versus Keyshawn Johnson is the Glenn matchup. Aaron Glenn on Terry Glenn, especially when Glenn is in the slot. We've all seen it. When Terry Glenn is on the football field for the New England Patriots, Pete Carroll is an okay, pretty good football coach, Chris.
Well, it's certainly defense. He pushes the envelope, and he'll have to push a little today. You know, Law and Keyshawn, the co-MVPs of the Pro Bowl, they were teammates the last game, head-to-head this time. That'll be fun. Well, later on, countdown, the heartwarming story of a son and his father and the expectations confronting Vinny Testaverde. Now, draft day, Mike Ditka let his hair down. Today, he hopes his only draft pick is ready to roll. New Orleans next.
Here at Bristol University, we seek verity for the truth.
The Bristol University School of Football.
Ricky Williams arriving at the Superdome. Hope he can let it roll for the New Orleans Saints at home today against Carolina. So this not just in, Mike Ditka, draft day, shipped away his entire draft to select Ricky Williams, the all-time leading NCAA rusher with the dreadlocks, was already posed for big-time magazines in a wedding dress with Ditka, and in the buff behind a surfboard with the greatest running back ever, Jim Brown. The Saints host the Carolina Panthers, starting anew with two-time Super Bowl winning coach George Seifert. Best behavior in the bayou, our Melissa Stark. Hi, Melissa.
Chris, Ricky Williams will start today. He practiced on Monday for the first time since suffering a high ankle sprain in the Saints preseason opener against the Dolphins. And although head coach Mike Ditka said he looked fluid and is 95% healed, he had just 9 carries all preseason.
Instead of going forward, I actually took some steps backwards, so it's going to be tough to get back on my feet. And it's just making the season harder for me. It was already going to be tough, and now it's a little bit tougher.
The only thing I'm worried about is if he hasn't carried the ball in traffic for a while since the Miami game. And, you know, I think, you know, going through there, and the ball could pop out once in a while, and I think that, you know, guys will be going after it.
It's going to take a couple carries, a couple nice shots before I feel like I'm a football player again.
Is there too much pressure on him? Maybe, I mean, he's a 22-year-old kid. Do you worry about that?
The only thing I worry a little bit about is I hope he doesn't put too much pressure on himself. He wants to do so well. He wants to be who he was in college, and sometimes that pressure, he's just going to have to let it come naturally. You can't push for it.
Williams said he doesn't know if he can play the entire game. Ditka worries about his endurance and said that if his rookie running back can carry the ball 30 times, he'll be the happiest man alive. And in case you're wondering, Williams won't be taking off his helmet during interviews anytime soon, Chris. He doesn't see the big deal. His coach thinks it's because he's extremely shy.
That's an interesting one. Bit shy? We'll see. Up next, replay is back inside the booth to see what's different.
down the field, lining up.
He's got it. He rolls. No ball hits the ground. We've got a touchdown.
Five for the Jets to try to take the lead in this football game. Testaverde, quarterback draw, down at the one. He got down to the one. Are they going to give it to him? Let's see. It sure didn't look like he got in, and it looked like he went down with a ball this side of the stripe.
Officially, Vinny Testaverde has 12 career rushing touchdowns. Officially. The Seahawks swear that it is 11. They say that Week 14 touchdown might have kept Seattle from the playoffs and might have cost Dennis Erickson his job. They say it was a bum call, hence, instant replay. Here's how it works. Each team gets two challenges a half. Lose a challenge, lose a timeout, except the last 2 minutes in overtime. You want to know exactly how the system works? Greg Garber played zebra.
See the ball come out, but the down marker gets in our way.
Mark Burns is one of 16 NFL replay assistants.
Okay, here it is, here it is, here it is.
Burns is the only in-booth holdover from the system that was abandoned 7 years ago.
What happened in the old system is you did not have any of this technology. All that was gone. And I say, oh, that's a great replay. Then what I'd have to do is put my machine on forward, put it back in record, go over to his machine, hit three buttons, and go over here and look. And then he'd be looking over here and say, oh, there's another replay. And I'd say, oh, that's even better. He would set his on record, and then I'd go over here and hit the three buttons, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth.
The old system was junked by the owners because it was slow and intruded on the game.
Why?
According to the NFL, new technology has solved that problem.
Here, what's beautiful in that you just touch a screen and it's right up there. So you can review a play within 10 seconds.
Jerry Seaman, a former referee, is now the senior director of official.
The beauty of it, for what we have upstairs with all the different replays, we can send down the first one or the second one that'll show it to them right away, so you don't have to sit there and go through all of the latitude and run it through.
Now it's all queued up. They might have six or eight angles. We go right to that spot. We get there. I said, I want end zone angle on this, the end line looking at it, and then we can make our decision.
Back on August 13th, when the Giants visited the Vikings in their preseason opener, the system was put to one of its early tests. In a pregame check, Burns, the replay assistant up in the booth, was the link to the on-field referee, played here by Seaman.
So if we've got a pass to the sideline, close catch, both feet in, I'm the replay assistant, I'm looking at the field, and I'm looking at the field and I'll say, wow, that's a close catch. By the time I say that, I'll look down here, and Ted will be just setting up the play.
Basically, when we want to review a play, when they come over here, the referee and the involved or involved officials will be involved to see the particular play.
So I'll look at this, and as I'm looking at this, I'm saying, wow, that's close. Lori will be saying, replay. When there's a replay, we'll come over, I'll look at the screen, and some replays are more applicable to the play than not.
Okay, let's go slow. Go backwards. Just go backwards and go slow. Back. Go real slow. Okay, now run at a regular speed.
Our goal is to get the perfect replay so that when the referee comes up to that screen, all he has to do is look at that one play and say, oh, I see why now it should be complete or not be incomplete.
There were no coaching challenges in the game. Just one false alarm when a coach inadvertently hit a button that signals a challenge.
This is as exciting as a high wire act, and now we're getting a chance to do it with a little safety net under. You don't want to be on a plane going home thinking that you maybe determine the outcome of the game.
In the preseason, replay was used 61 times in 63 games. 14 of those were reversed. The average time of each review was 57 seconds. The first reversal in the new system came in the Steelers-Bears game.
As you can see, as we get close in that end zone, it's a question, did the Pittsburgh player fall on the ball in the end zone? And if he did that, it would be a touchdown. Or when he got control of the ball, was he out of bounds? Now, the referee on this particular play ruled that we have a safety. Now, this is exactly the type of play that we want because it involves scoring. Now we will see another angle of it. You can piece things together, too. Now watch him throw that football out. So he definitely had control of the ball inbound. So this was a nice reversal. We changed this from a safety to a touchdown, properly done.
Still, there were flaws, including equipment malfunction and human errors in judgment.
We're still dealing with human beings. I'm not going to pretend
that everything is going to be letter perfect. I mean, we would be naive if we would expect that.
Greg, thanks. Now remember, you lose a challenge, you lose a timeout, except the last 2 minutes of each half and overtime. Basically, what replay covers is end zone to end zone, sideline to sideline. Did a runner break the plane? Did he break the goal line? Was he down before he fumbled? It does not cover judgment plays like pass interference. Marty, you were on the competition committee back in 1986 when replay was first brought in. You were also involved in the first game where replay was used against the Bears. What do you think, good or bad?
Stuart, it's interesting. The play just reviewed by Jerry Seaman was exactly the circumstance that we were involved with there. I'm opposed to it. I'm particularly opposed to the challenge system aspect of this thing. What's going to happen is coaches are going to find themselves in very difficult situations where they're going to get second-guessed. You should have used it. You shouldn't have used it. Basically, the officiating, in my view, should be left to the officials, and the balance of that coaching can be left to us.
All right, calm down. Like you said, you don't care who wins anymore. All right, still ahead here on Sunday NFL Countdown. Can the Jags, Fred Taylor, improve on his 17-touchdown sensational rookie season? And how about the 49ers? Steve Young, good problem to have. Let's see. Stokes, Owens, Rice. Who do I throw it to?
Leading into our game at Cleveland with the Steelers. Well, you know what? I'm not really sure that 45 minutes on primetime will be long enough for this game. 12-4 San Francisco at 11-5 Jacksonville. Despite the winds of change in San Francisco, and they're more like a hurricane, all head coach Steve Mariucci has done is win 25 regular season games in 2 years. You got some guy named Steve Young at quarterback, some guy, Jerry Rice, wide receiver, but alas, no Garrison Hurst at running back. As for the Jags, they have a full bag, led by quarterback Mark Brunell, running back Fred Taylor, who some say may have close to 2,000 yards in this only his second season. And 3 straight years in the playoffs for Tom Coughlin should get rosier. Remember, the AFC Central champs have 10 division games in a very weak division. To Jacksonville we go, and Sean Salisbury. Sean-O, here we go again.
The 49ers start this season with their most unsettled running game since Derek Lavelle took over for Ricky Waters in 1995. Today, Charlie Garner gets the start with his backup, Lawrence Phillips, also expected to get some touches.
It might be a very productive, or it might not be as productive as last year, but it might be even more. We don't know. We've got two-headed horsemen going right now, and we'll let it unfold. We have no idea.
I think they have a very good replacement, Garner. I've seen him play. I played against him. I know what kind of back he is. He's fast. He's quick. He's a tough running back. And not only can he run the ball, but he's good in the passing game.
When you study, though, you realize that the teams that have had success against the 49ers have really not allowed a runner to get to 100 yards. They've held them under 100 yards rushing. And the thing that you have to always be concerned with is big play.
And that usually starts with Steve Young and ends with Terrell Owens, J.J. Stokes, or Jerry Rice, who'll all get plenty of chances.
We're going to be involved in some aggressive zone blitz, which means the ends have got to come off. Hopefully they can get in the way of one of those slants or something of that nature. But you've got to change up, and you've got to be prepared to understand where they're going with their game and then be a step ahead of them. If you're a step behind them, you have problems.
With the release this week of his partner, Merton Hanks, safety Tim McDonald is the only returning starter in the Niners' secondary, and he is looking for help from a guy not known for his defense.
We're counting heavily on Charles Barkley.
We'll count on him too, man.
Charles Barkley, geez. Charles Haley, Chuck.
If Chuck could get to the quarterback, I'm sure the Niners would sign him. With the offseason departures of Roy Barker and Chris Dolman, San Francisco lost 27 sacks. And Sterling, McDonald also told me the D lineman Gabe Wilkins has got to play better this year.
Well, when you talk about defense, that's the one thing the Jacksonville Jaguars have got to do this year with that high-powered offense. They had 30 sacks all of last year. They had 10 in 3 preseason games, and you get a chance to see the pressure that Dom Capers is going to bring to the Jacksonville Jaguars. 2 things have to happen. That zone blitz scheme not only has to get to the quarterback, they have to shut down the running game, and probably most importantly, they have got to stay healthy. This is probably the most talented team this franchise has had in their history. If they can stay healthy, they got a great shot of being in Atlanta during the Super Bowl.
And they'll get more than 30 sacks this year with Dom Capers coaching that defense. But when you start talking about health, nothing more important to San Francisco than keeping Steve Young healthy. You take a look at some footage from last year. This is a guy who was the beneficiary of almost 1,600 yards of rushing offense compliments of Garrison Hurst, and yet the 49ers were sacked 53 times. With the spread offense, they want to bring the zone blitz system. Now, Bracken, 17.5 sacks in 43 games. Can you say Kevin Green and Greg Lloyd? Look for Dom Capers to bring him off that end against Dave Fiore, who has limited experience. It will be the matchup, not only of this game, but I think a matchup for the 49ers to look at their left tackle over the course of the season.
Fiore, some of that line a little banged up to start the season. The last time San Francisco had a road game in Florida was a week one 2 years ago in Tampa. Steve Young, Jerry Rice, not good. But one thing out of San Francisco, everybody knew, more pressure, lots of blitzes, lots of gambling, which I think will be lots of points in this game.
Yeah.
One of the great stories, Bryant Young. Going to start, play 20 or 25 plays. Nobody's worked harder the last 8 months than Bryant Young to get back on the field. Ahead, Southpaw quarterbacks, how Steve Young and Mark Brunello, just a little left of center. Not since 83 as a draft in his quarterback riches this one. We'll take a look at how they're adjusting. And Joey's team, the birthday boy, talks to the head of the class, Tim Couch, about what it's like to be a Brown.
Dog Brown.
What's your problem?
No one else is insulted by this guy.
Hey, take it easy.
What? I'm having a good time. I just want to know if our friend here has ever done any time in a real dog pound.
That's just a thing. It's no big deal.
Yeah. Save it for the Humane Society, you poser.
It's the Steelers against the Browns on ESPN Sunday Night Football. It all begins at NFL primetime at 7:30.
In the future.
I'm Donovan McNabb from Syracuse University. People are beginning to realize that the drop back passer is just not going to get it done.
I'm Tim Couch from University of Kentucky. When I see the tight coverage, the safety's down, I know something big about to happen.
I'm Cade McNown from UCLA.
When I'm just, doing what I'm coached to do, I try and be as finesse as possible.
I'm Dante Culpepper. I'm a quarterback, and I don't fear anything.
My name is Akili Smith from the University of Oregon. My dad got my name out of a Swahili dictionary, and that means power, intelligence, and creativity.
Five fat first-round picks as quarterbacks, and none of the five will start. Tim Couch, the only college QB to ever complete 400 passes in one season, he asked Peyton Manning, last year's number one, whether it was best to start immediately or watch and learn. Said Manning, start, definitely. Yeah, what quarterback wouldn't say that if it was his playing time in question? Certainly not Joey's team. Joe Theismann joins us now from Cleveland, where he will call the huge game tonight. Joe, you turned 50 years old in 9-9-99. Happy birthday. And you spent some time with Tim Couch. What were your impressions of this year's overall number one pick?
Well, first of all, Stuart, it's great to be here in Cleveland. This is an incredible atmosphere. It's almost like a Super Bowl. And it's unfortunate Tim Couch is not going to have the opportunity to start tonight for the Cleveland Browns. But that doesn't necessarily mean that his future may be postponed. We could see him sometime through the course of the evening. He's put a lot of time, a lot of effort in, a lot of energy to trying to become a starting quarterback. It's starting to pay off, and he's starting to look pretty darn good.
You're up now. Okay.
Couch drops back to pass. Protection's good. He's going for it. Oh, Johnson's there. He's got it. Touchdown.
What have you noticed the biggest difference between pro ball and college ball?
The biggest thing I've noticed is, the players are a lot smarter. They've seen things so many more times than the guys in college. Like, for example, the DBs, they've seen the route so many times, they get an extra jump on the ball.
Welcome to the National Football League's 99 draft.
What seems to be the general theme you guys talk about?
Right now, we're all just talking about how tough the NFL is, so we're all kind of trying to help each other get through that.
You've gotten advice from different quarterbacks. I'm going to mention some names, and you share with me, if you would, some of the advice they've given you. Peyton Manning.
He just gave me a lot of advice on how to handle the pressure of dealing with the media and the expectations of being a number one pick.
Ty Detmer.
Ty's taught me a lot about the on-field stuff, reading coverages, just being patient out there, being calm, and I think, I've learned a lot just by sitting back and watching Ty.
One of the traditional Browns, Bernie Kosar.
Bernie's taught me a lot about off-the-field stuff here in Cleveland, about how the fans, really embrace the players here in this town.
When you were Kentucky,
How many plays were in your playbook?
I would say we probably had about 15 pass plays maybe, and four or five running plays.
Now all of a sudden, you come to Cleveland, Coach Palmer hands you a playbook that in itself just has 100 pass plays.
It was a little intimidating. You know, I knew there was going to be a lot of studying going on, you know, when I first got the book. Looking at him, if he gets the depth off the ball and takes away that, I might as well come straight backside to try to hit the dig in this window here. I've had to put a lot of time and effort into watching film and, you know, keeping my head in the playbook and just trying to learn the offense.
In your mind, would you be ready Sunday night if you had to?
I think so. I mean, I could go out, you know, run the offense, get the team in the right play. You know, sure, there would be some mistakes and things, but I think that would be typical for a rookie quarterback. But I feel confident I could play if something, happened to me.
Tim Couch is not going to get an opportunity to start tonight against the Pittsburgh Steelers. But as Coach Palmer has said, he left it open to competition. Who was going to have the job? And it turned out being Ty Detmer. He's the more veteran. He's the guy that's going to open tonight. But don't be surprised, Stuart, if the game starts to get away a little bit, if we don't see Tim Couch, not only in this game, as the season goes on, we'll see a little bit more of him. And I personally think he's got a terrific opportunity to be somebody very special in the National Football League.
All right, Joe, we appreciate your thoughts, and we will see you tonight. It's called a segue. Because tonight, not to toot our own horn, what the heck, we will. Our first NFL game of the year, Sunday Night Football on ESPN, a thick AFC Central rivalry reborn. Join Mike Patrick, Joe, and Paul McGuire, Steelers-Browns tonight, 8 p.m., 8:15 exactly on ESPN. Still up on Sunday NFL Countdown, 1,458 yards from the all-time rushing record. Barry left and left the Lions lurching. The fellas, maybe a step slower than their three Super Bowl days, but Troy Emmett, the playmaker, still have magic. And Vinny Testaverde, he went from being stand-up comedy material to the highest-rated QB in the AFC. And if Gary Anderson would have made the only field goal last year that he missed, revenge on the Vikings' mind.
Today's 4th Century Classic Moment is brought to you by Burger King.
We had a special play that we thought would be successful because nobody thinks that the quarterback is going to be a receiver. And he's eligible in this situation. And Tony Nathan got the ball and did a good job of making it look like a sweep to the right stop and threw the ball across the field to Woodley, who was wide open for a touchdown. It hadn't been done before, and I don't think it's been done since.
That was September 12, 1982.
At Burger King, we're always trying to make having your way better. Like this idea for a win your way college football game.
Two more tries!
Run back a kickoff and win great prizes. Then we thought, why not just scratch and win? This week, Penn State and Miami face off, and you could win $1 million, a Toyota RAV4, or the best tasting prize of all, a delicious Whopper. Burger King. When you have it your way, it just tastes better.
Sunday NFL Countdown. Just as much fun as it ever was. Back to the NFC title rematch, Minnesota at Atlanta. It was all set up. Vikings fans had their plane reservations to Miami. Suntan all being wrapped up in purple. Championship game at home where a month earlier the Vikings had beaten the Jags, for example, 50-10. Just a mere formality, right? But a funny thing happened on the way to the Forum. Here's Kenny Mayne.
Three teams have been 15-1 in the history of the National Football League. All right, give yourselves a round of applause.
Last season was magical for Minnesota. The Vikings broke through and broke out, enjoying a courtship with the end zone, the intensity of which the league had never seen.
Buchanan cannot guard me.
No, I know that.
What they didn't know is how quickly it would all come crashing down.
The kick, it's on the way, it's up, and it's good! The Falcons are going to the Super Bowl!
We hadn't watched the film until now, and got to a point where I said, Ray, I don't want to watch anymore of this. Because, you know, you have a game won, and then whatever happens, you just don't get there. And it really does hurt.
You don't play 60 minutes, you don't win.
They played better than we played. I mean, we dropped passes, we dropped interceptions, we fumbled the ball, we give up sacks.
We didn't finish the game like we could have. And, time ran out on us. Time ran out on us.
Super Bowl last year?
Yes. I didn't actually go to the game, though.
Don't want to see it. I've seen enough football.
I watched like a quarter, and that was it. And I turned it off. And it really hurt at the time. It did. At the time, it really did hurt.
8 months and endless thoughts later, Fate and the schedule makers have the Vikings face-to-face with the Falcons. And it would seem the path.
I think the National Football League loves this type of drama.
The NFL is about distractions. And the more you pay attention to it, the more distracted you get. I won't see this interview. I won't see the articles because I don't choose to read them. You choose to get distracted. You don't get distracted. I'm trying to win football games. I'm not trying to read what anybody else thinks about the prospects of a replay of the championship game. That means absolutely nothing to me.
Winning this game doesn't necessarily mean that we are the best team in the league. What it means is that we're 1-0.
No win will settle. It's just one game. It's just one game, and our goal is, you know, to win our division, you know, win our conference, try to win as many games as possible, get home field advantage, and Atlanta is a part of that now.
I just go in looking at it, this is another team, a new beginning, and another chance of going to the Super Bowl.
Big dogs are in the house!
Last year when we played, the objective was win this one game in the Super Bowl. So regardless, they'll never be the same. They'll never be the same.
I don't even want to conceive losing this year. I don't want to think about it. I just want to make sure that each time we step on the football field, we're doing everything we can.
Well, thank you, Kenny. Had a great year with a bad ending, and I think you can see the seeds of that championship game defeat against Arizona. We talked about it last year. I know Tommy and I did on primetime that they're kind of fooling around with single wings, even though they beat that team by 20. And then I think more they get their halves mixed up. At the end of the first half, they need to be cautious. At the end of the game, they needed to be bold, and they got it mixed up, and I think it hurt them. And at the Pro Bowl, we talked to all the players. Robert Smith in particular says, I can't wait for training camp to start. Could they really wait? Are they that excited?
No, this preseason, I think they were out of sync. I think there's reason to be concerned about the Vikings. You go back to that game against the Falcons in January. Remember, the Atlanta Falcons got after Randall Cunningham. They protected him so clean all year long in that game. The defensive front, I think one of the most underrated units in football, Lester Archambault and Travis Hall and Chuck Smith and Shane Drene, they did not give Randall Cunningham time to throw. If that happens again today, I think the Vikings lose.
I think you're exactly right. Not to mention what they did in the secondary, talking about the Atlanta Falcons. The one thing they did was disrupt the timing of Randall Cunningham and threw off the stride of Randy Moss. We saw things in this game that we weren't accustomed to seeing during the course of the year. Right here, Randall Cunningham throwing the ball over the top. Hard to believe he underthrows Randy Moss right here. Right here, Randy Moss in the end zone for what is pretty sure to be a touchdown, dropped the football. And what they were able to do was disrupt timing because they kept changing up their defenses and they took chances. And when you take chances, you're going to win some and you're going to lose some. And that day, the Atlanta Falcons won some.
I think people should get off Gary Anderson's back, by the way. If you think that the one field goal that he misses the reason they're not
Don't
in the
start
Super Bowl,
sorry I think
that is he doesn't have a big back. Oh, that's what I mean. He's a little guy. Look it up for the little guys. That's all. Let's go back now to the, speaking of back, somebody said that. Back to the Patriots and the Jets. It was a storybook season, certainly, for Vinny Testaverde. Back in his native New York, leading the Jets almost all the way to the Super Bowl, leading himself to the Pro Bowl. But a month after that, an abrupt change for Vinny, as his dad, Al, with whom he was very close, passed away. Susie Culber, Vinny's got a few things on his mind today.
Play in person or even on live TV since Vinny's pro debut in 1987. At that game, Al Testaverde suffered a heart attack in the stands at Tampa Stadium. Well, last January, when the Jets made the AFC Championship game, Al actually joked that if the Jets won, he'd be sitting in the stands at the Super Bowl. Why risk it? Well, he said if he was going to die, that's how he would want to go, with a smile on his face.
Testaverde dropped back to throw. Touchdown! Touchdown, New York Jets! A wonderfully thrown ball by Testaverde.
I look back at last year and how exciting it was, and I'm just very glad that things went the way they did for a number of reasons. And the biggest is that, my father passing in February was able to enjoy all that excitement that we had a year ago.
Al Testaverde was Vinny's best friend and biggest fan.
Together, they celebrated the success, like the Heisman in 86.
Dad, we dreamed it together. We lived it together. And tonight I could probably say that we won it together.
And Vinny's first Pro Bowl appearance a decade later, a rare opportunity to see his son play in person. They also suffered through 10 losing seasons, until in storybook fashion, the boy from Elmont, New York came home. Bill Parcells' system fit, and so did his roots.
He reminds me a lot of my father in the same traits and the same way he carries himself and goes about his daily stuff.
We just have similar upbringings, that's all. We just come from the same background, generally the same location, the same type of family, the same basic heritage. So, I mean, I identify with him. We've kind of kidded around where you had to sit at the kitchen table when you were there. You know, there was a certain way that the family does it, and his was the same, you know, and that's the way it is.
I had the opportunity to work with my father on a lot of his construction jobs. Much the way I work with Coach Parcells on the field, there a lot of the things they do are very similar in working with my father working with his men on the job and Coach working with the players. Demanding results. And when he gets it, he's pleased, but when he doesn't, he's the bear to be around.
Vinny tested that temper as he got off to a slow start this summer. Al had become a fixture at every practice, and Vinny was distracted by his absence.
We understand that, you know, he's going to go through a little tough time early in the season, especially because his dad meant so much to him. But at the same time, Vinny's going to be professional, and he's going to do what he's supposed to do.
Immerse himself in his job, his family, and his father's lessons.
My role model has always been my father, a man that I've always looked up to because of the way he's handled himself in situations, certain situations, the way he's raised his family, the way he taught us about life.
For anyone's dad to be able to say that his life was fulfilled for what his son did, like, who could possibly ask for more than that?
Well, it's a good feeling to know that you know, he was a very happy man and enjoyed what I did for a living, enjoyed in taking pride in the success that I had and that we had as a team a year ago.
Just 1 week before Al passed away, Jets quarterback coach Dan Henning called him. He just wanted to tell Al that of all the years he had coached, he felt that Vinny's season was the finest of any QB he had ever coached. And Jim, that was the moment to cherish for Vinny and his dad. There's everything that Vinny had gone through didn't matter.
That's exactly right, Susie, because everybody knows they'd love to be as close like Vinny was to his father. That's the way I was with my father. And I spoke to Dan Henning. He said, Vinny's the type of quarterback that's going to go in there, have fun, his priorities are exactly in order. No ego, but one thing he said he had to do was get Vinny ready for Sunday. He said one thing that impressed him and jumped out more than anything last year was Vinny Testaverde on third down efficiency, ranked number one in the National Football League. 10 touchdowns, most importantly, zero interceptions.
Wow. Well, he played some great football last year, and he was the beneficiary of the philosophy of Bill Parcells in running the football. It is not necessarily for per carry average. It is about creating in the mind of the defense the thought that we are going to run the football. It opens up play action down the football field. The Jets ran the ball 500 times on the nose last year. Bill Parcells told me this week he plans to do the same thing this year. Now, let's see. Ted Johnson, one of the better run stoppers, middle linebacker for the Patriots, out of the game. Andy Katzmoyer, a great All-American college player, proven nothing in the pros. What could happen there?
My favorite, Mike might have a few antennas. Ray Walston will even be pleased. By the way, no Krabbett, of course, for 6 weeks, but that Diedrich Ward, who now starts, big play guy, had the big catch again in that big Buffalo game on the road last year. Jets, you always think I want to report that? Jets have lots of weapons. Great piece, Susie. With the Jets at home, the Giants now hit the road at the new Sombrero to face the Buccaneers. New York and Tampa Bay really had similar seasons. Playoff teams in 97, 8-8 in 98, but not without signs that last year they really were a lot better. The Giants, remember, ended Denver's 13-0 run. They won five of their last six. The Bucs, the only team to beat the Vikings all year, they split with the Packers. They also beat the Giants 20-3 last season, as Bucs defensive back Rondae Barber got bragging rights over twin brother, Giants running back Tiki Barber. Tampa Bay buoyed by a 4-0 preseason. By the way, the offense, which people question, they had 117 points in the preseason. That's the most. Warren Sapp, lighter and even quicker. Ahead on NFL Countdown, we head out to Green Bay to see what the season holds for Brett Favre without Mike Holmgren, without Robert Brooks, but pretty good rest of the cast. And Joey Galloway, wide receiver Seahawks, joins us live, but not from Seattle. We'll talk to him about it. Stay with us. Welcome back to Sunday NFL Countdown. Oakland and Green Bay do not meet very often. They are linked, of course, by history to Super Bowl II. Today, they tangle on the not-yet-frozen tundra of Lambeau Field. And at home, Brett Favre, an obscene 53-6 as a starter in the regular and postseason games. The 8-8 ratings, meanwhile, turned to Rich Gannon at quarterback this season. The 11-5 Packers, undefeated in the preseason, have a new coach and head coach in Ray Rhodes, who was their defensive coordinator there in the early 90s when now Raiders head coach John Gruden also was a Packer assistant on Mike Holmgren's first coaching staff. Familiarity may not breed contempt, but there is a game to win. Never, ever breeding contempt. I'm Mike Golden. Welcome, Michael.
Thank you, Boom. It's a great day here in the Dairyland where the Packers look kind of like Swiss cheese, meaning they have some holes to fill. They lost wide receiver Robert Brooks to retirement head coach Mike Holmgren to Seattle. So new coach Ray Rhodes has given the keys to the offense to coordinator Sherm Lewis. The plan, take this offensive machine and step on the gas.
Sherm Lewis really opened up the playbook. You know, it's just open for whatever now. And whereas when Mike Holmgren was here, it was a little more squished together.
We're going to throw it 30-something times a game on an average, I would think. That's pretty high. But we use that as a ball control weapon for us. Even though you're throwing the ball, we're eating the clock up.
The biggest hole of all on defense, where new coordinator Emmett Thomas needs to craft a game plan that won't include the game's all-time sack leader, Reggie White.
That's a lot of sacks. And that's something that's going to be very hard to replace. But I think the leadership, I mean, we got me, so take care of that. Forget about it.
I don't think of myself for really replacing him. You know, I'm just the next guy in line. I don't think anybody could ever step in the shoes of Reggie White. He led by example, and I'm just happy to have the opportunity to play behind him.
Oakland's defense was dominant in the preseason, allowing only about 10 points per game. But now, here comes Brett Favre and Antonio Freeman.
The thing about Favre is he's confident in his abilities, and he tries his best to, you know, display that he's a tough guy, and, you know, no matter what, the hits aren't going to bother him. But the fact is that, you know, I don't care what you say, a hit's going to hurt. And the fact is that I put him on quarterback, so I'm going to do whatever I can to get to him.
It's kind of like that, kind of like a hit and miss, you know what I'm saying? Either you cover him and you let the defensive line get to the quarterback, or you don't cover him and then they beat you for a touchdown.
With the trade of Craig Newsome, Mike McKenzie becomes the first rookie to start at cornerback for Green Bay since, well, Craig Newsome in 95. Also in the nickel package, another rookie, Antoine Edwards, will come in at safety. And Sterling, I know you'd be licking your chops if you lined up across the field from a couple of rooks.
Well, you're exactly right, because that's what you want, an opportunity to catch a lot of passes, get out to get your team started early, making plays. I think the secondary advantage goes to the Oakland Raiders with two veterans now, with Charles Woodson now having a year. Two veterans goes to the Oakland Raiders. The offensive line for both teams will be thoroughly tested today because of the blitzing by both teams. Oakland gave up 67 sacks last season. Ray Rhodes, the head coach of the Green Bay Packers, wasn't happy with his preseason view of his offensive line. But I think it all is going to boil down to two people. It's going to be Rich Gannon and Brett Favre. And Brett Favre has a lot more input in game planning this year than he did last.
And there's a lot of, if you're going to like the Packers this year, it's going to be because of Brett Favre. And I think you have to go back to Brett's offseason. Brett addressed a lot of issues in his life, and he will tell you alcohol was one of those issues. He's cut it out of his life. He's dropped 20 pounds. He's studying film more. And I think the Packers are pretty excited about what they've got in that quarterback. Not that he wants to be just a great quarterback who went to the Super Bowl. He wants to be one of the all-time best. I think he has a chance to do it.
Right. No question about that. A couple things you should remember about Green Bay. They got three McKenzie. With this Mike McKenzie, three McKenzies playing. Not to mention Pat McKenzie.
Right, yep.
Means the McKenzie brothers. And the other thing to remember is Bonnie Holiday. Big-time season.
Yes.
Big-time
yes.
Season, Bonnie Holiday. We are cuckoo sometimes. At any rate, gone from Green Bay, where he turned a 4-12 team into a Super Bowl champion, is Mike Holmgren, who is now being asked to do the same in Seattle. The Seahawks have not been to the playoffs since 1988. Now, that's the longest drought in the league, 88. But at 8-8 last year, I mean, they are hardly the three sisters of the poor. They are a postseason force waiting to happen, even if it's with a young quarterback, John Kitna. But don't forget, Kitna 4-2 as a starter last year. Only two losses, Denver and to the Jets in that contested Vinny touchdown game. Into town come the 5-11 Detroit Lions, now without Barry Sanders. The pieces are in place for Seattle. Except for a very big piece, the best player never to make a Pro Bowl, Joey Galloway. Stu, he's not holding out on us, is he?
No, he is with us. And I tell you what, Joey Galloway, one of the few men in the history of this league, sorry, Sterling, who've been able to cover 40 yards in 4.2 seconds. But the only place that Joey Galloway has been running lately has been the Woody Hayes Center in Columbus, Ohio, the guy not in Seattle's camp. Joey Galloway, 41 touchdowns in just 4 years, is holding out. He has not been in camp all year. He says he was promised a contract extension before this season, but that was before new head coach Mike Holmgren came to town. Galloway staying in shape, waiting for something to happen. And Joey would probably rather be spatting his cleats right now than sitting at home talking to us, but here he is. Joey, thanks for hanging out. As Boomer just said, you're the best player never to make a Pro Bowl. Now, you might be in Hawaii come February, but if this keeps up, you won't be playing. What has to be done to get you into camp?
Well, first off, we need to start talks again. You know, there hasn't been too many talks going on since they gave us the ultimatum of, you know, either accept or offer or nothing. So, you know, the first thing would help if we began talking again. And I think we can reach an agreement, but both sides have to be fair.
Now, on paper, a lot of people would say that Mike Holmgren's a perfect fit for you. Since he was offensive coordinator in San Francisco a decade ago, he's had a guy either lead the league in catches or receiving yards or both five times. Sterling Sharp, Antonio Freeman, and that Rice guy. Don't you want that?
I definitely want that. But at the same time, you know as well as I do that this is a business now. You know, this is the way I pay my bills. My first loyalty is to my family. You know, I have people to take care of on this end of it. So, you know, from that standpoint, I have to take care of those things first and then the football end of it.
Has there been anything that's happened in the last 24 hours that at least gives you hope that this thing might get done soon?
Not at all. You know, the only thing that's really happened is I spoke to my brothers, and next Sunday I'll be playing flag football.
Now, a lot of people would say, all right, we know that you took a $300,000 salary cut this year because you thought your deal would get reworked, but still, you're under contract. Get into camp. What do you say about that?
Well, you know, from a business standpoint, I want to be paid what the market shows. You know, and right now, there's been a number of guys who play my position who have received the longer contracts, and that's what I want. I want to be in Seattle. I want to sign the long deal. I want to play in Coach Holmgren's offense. I want all those things. But for that to happen, both sides have to come together and get something done.
Joey, obvious question. Are you willing to sit out the entire year if this thing doesn't happen the way that you think it should?
I'm definitely willing. You know, football is very important to me, but it's not my life. You know, like I said, next Sunday I'll be playing flag football with my brothers. I'm not going to sit around and mope about this thing. I'm going to continue to work out like I've been doing, hoping that it does get done because I'd love to be playing right now. But if it doesn't work out that way, I'm absolutely fine.
All right, Joey, get seven guys if this thing doesn't work out, and the seven of us will take you and your brothers on in flag football. Joey Galloway averaged 38 yards per touchdown catch last year. Thanks for the time. I mentioned it. The Bengals, they locked up their all-time leading receiver, Carl Pickens, to a brand-new deal. 5 years, $23.25 million. Cincinnati plays Tennessee today. The Titans with New York.
Seconds left. Got to go to the end zone now. Three-man rush. And Young stumbles on the way back. And finally, he fires at the middle. Passes caught by Owens. Owens made the catch. Oh, special bubble. This is amazing. And welcome back to Studio 2A, Kickoff 99 and Fox NFL Sunday. You know, the bitter taste of that last-second touchdown catch by Terrell Owens is still in the mouths of Packer fans, who also had to bid farewell to their superb coach, Mike Holmgren, who, of course, is in Seattle. But now in his place is Ray Rhodes, who has brought in a new coaching staff, a shotgun formation for Brett Favre, and, judging by the preseason, plenty of enthusiasm. But the question is, can the new-look Pack get it back? Our own Jeannie Zelasco is in Green Bay for today's Raiders-Packers game with more. And hello, Jeannie.
Hi, JB. It is definitely strange around here. As you mentioned, Mike Holmgren has moved on, and there is no Reggie White. But there is a part of the Packers' recent past that does linger. That, of course, being the devastating loss in San Francisco some 7 months ago. That was an educational experience for the Packers that survived it. They are well aware if you don't learn from history, you are destined to repeat it.
I think we really owe the team as a secondary
pretty much owe him a game, because the last time we were out on the field was because of the secondary. So we got three guys in the first three rounds. Now to help us with our depth in the secondary.
But for Ray Rhodes and the Packers, the first concern is the fact the reinforcements are more green than gold. And without Reggie White to help polish the act, it's Leroy Butler's job to make sure the rookies know what they're up against.
To let them know that when they see Tim Brown today, it'll be like they've never seen before. The regular season is something like you never imagined, not even when you were a kid.
At times, you're going to play young players. And then, a few years ago, the Raiders lined up with a rookie in Woodson.
The Woodson experiment turned out just fine. Quarterback took Defensive Rookie of the Year honors thanks to the guidance of head coach John Gruden, who was once guided by Ray Rhodes in Philadelphia. They're still good friends. Well, friends, except for 3 hours today.
He doesn't have any friends on game day if you're on the other team. You know, he's a serious competitor, and anybody that knows Ray Rhodes knows that. And all friendship aside, this is Oakland against Green Bay, and the players are going to decide the outcome of this one.
Speaking of decisions, John Gruden made a big one this offseason. He said he needed a new quarterback. He brought in Rich Gannon, a better fit for his system. Even though he's not your prototypical Raiders quarterback, he doesn't have a Raiders swagger yet, or that howitzer arm. On the other side of the ball, of course, why mess with a good thing? Oakland's defense finished fifth overall, and Darrell Russell had a Pro Bowl season, expectations the same for 99. And by the way, JB, we're around the Oakland front office is that Mr. Russell is the second coming of a man you're well familiar with, Howie Long.
Wow, big compliment indeed. Thank you very much, Jeannie. You know what? Everybody wants to be the second coming of Howie Long, though, huh? A failed movie star.
Oh, let it go.
Oh. We'll give Howie a chance to come back at that later. There are plenty of other great games, including the return of the Browns and Steelers rivalry. That headline, check it out. Tonight, look out, fire hydrants. The dog pound is back as the Browns slobber up for the Steelers. Speaking of comebacks, Pittsburgh's Cordell hopes for just that after last year's meltdown. While Tim Couch fans are down, the top pick is on a pine couch in favor of Ty Detmer. While the real world asks about Y2K, Buffalo fans are asking Y2QB. Nevertheless, it's Doug's job to lose. Facing Flutie are the Colts, who now have a running man to go with their main man, Manny. Keeping it in the East, the play host to the rival Patriots. Team Tuna swept New England last year, but as Bill told his team, it's time to start over. Starting over are the Tennessee Oilers. Titans, that is. They changed their name, their stadium, and the uniform. However, they wouldn't change today's opponent, the Bengals, who were dismal last year. Dismal once described the Rams' rushing attack. So, say hello to their new Marshall Plan. Rams wham with Brian Billick and the new-look Ravens. The Chiefs-Bears clash has a new look as well. Out are Schottenheimer and Wanstead, and in are Cunningham and Duran. Check this out. The Bears' Shane Matthews and Cade McNown should both see action today. Monday! It's the old versus the new, with a borrowed coach and a very blue Bronco.
If it was just between me and Mike, I probably wouldn't come back.
Sorry, Bubby. Agresti is the man again, this time versus Miami.
You gonna play it now, but I don't mind.
Folks, have we got a treat for you today. Throughout this season, we will have a number of NFL players guesting on our show. Today, we start off with an outstanding one. Arguably the best inside linebacker in the game today, spearheading that San Diego Charger defense, Junior Seau, 8 consecutive years of Pro Bowl.
Hey, not just linebacker now, tight end. He's actually proven that he may be an athlete.
I'm tired of hearing about Champ Bailey, Woodson. We finally got a big skill guy here.
But yes. The question is, though, why are you here?
I can answer that. The worst teams don't play on opening day.
That is true.
For some reason, you guys don't think that we pick up ratings on TV, and therefore we got to wait. Right? Is that what it is? It has nothing to do with us winning only 5 games a year, buddy.
No.
Got a question from the quarterback over here.
Well, the first thing I want to know is your situation defensively is outstanding. Your situation offensively is not very good. Ryan Leaf, your guy that's not going to play. What's going on in San Diego? I want to know what's happening with this guy.
Right now, what we have Ryan Leaf doing is rehabbing a shoulder in which he injured, during minicamp. But right now, we're focused on Jim Harbaugh and Eric Kramer. We have two quality quarterbacks that are going to lead the way on offense, hopefully get us some time on defense so we can recover. And if we can have that, you're going to see us in the playoffs, and you guys are all going to hate me.
Brian Griese is the man at the helm for the Denver Broncos. Good move, bad move? Are you licking your chops at this?
Well, it's a good move for the organization, I think. I believe that if you're going to implement a rookie quarterback, to do that, what you have to have is people around him. You have a great running back. You have a great offensive line with Alex Gibbs leading the helm. You have a great receiver. So what better time to do it with a rookie than now? You're losing the legend, and no one's ever going to replace him. So
how about the AFC? Other than the Cincinnati Bengals, who scares you out there in the AFC?
Did you play?
Don't try that. I was a good player. Don't try that.
Cincinnati Bengals are going to be a great team, and we're looking forward to them next week. So, but other than that, you have your Mark Brunell, you know, the Jacksonville Jaguars. They're definitely going to be one of the contending factors.
Hold it, Junior. Yes. What is this?
What is that?
You know what that is?
What's that?
That is Junior. Had they when they played the Detroit Lions,
right.
It's very sensitive.
Oh, that's embarrassing. Oh. It looked like one of your techniques after you throwing an interception.
We will give you an opportunity to hit Terry a little later when you and Howie are out here on the Fox football field demonstrating things that you do so successfully on the football field. That'll be coming up later in the program. All right, folks, coming up on Fox NFL Sunday, the big game in Landover, Maryland today. Dallas and Washington. We'll talk about that matchup. And also Minnesota at Atlanta, an NFC title game rematch that, folks, will have long-term implications.
It could easily come down to whoever wins this game might have the home field advantage or playoff implications. So it makes a little bigger right now.
Division champ glow. But if Chan Gailey's Cowboys of a year ago became only the third team 27 teams in the last two decades to have a winless preseason to make the playoffs. I mean, this year they went 1-4. It should be easy, right? Is the sky the limit? After all, those names with the three rings on their fingers are still there. And what's the limit for the Redskins, though? New owner, two dozen new front office personnel, including new GM, a win or else dictum, but new quarterback Brad Johnson, a great draft pick in Champ Bailey, and a good but not great division means division championship for Washington is possible. Brad Johnson will not have to worry about throwing against Deion Sanders today. Go to Washington and Ed Werder. Ed?
Outside the Cowboys locker room, Deion Sanders not going to play today. Deion, how bad is the foot and how close are you able to make him again?
I'm not going to say it's terribly bad. I'm going to say it's healing. I mean, I'm getting close. Until I can give my teammates what they're expected of me and give the fans what they're expecting and give myself what I expect, I cannot do it.
Is this an injury that still scares you?
No, it don't scare me. I mean, I just got to learn to trust my toe a little more because I still feel the pain. I'm going to have to play with pain. I know that. But I don't want to do nothing, and we don't want to do nothing to set me backwards and avoid all the hard work and determination that we've had thus far.
What about next week, Monday night against Atlanta?
I know everybody's going to be hyping that up since it's my old team, my old rivalry, you know, that is dear in my heart. And is he going to play? He's waiting to be in the spotlight on Monday night. I want to play and help this team when I'm capable of doing what I'm accustomed to do. I got some high standards out there.
All right, Deion Sanders will be replaced today by Charlie Williams. Let's go back to the studio.
All right, Ed, thank you very much. Mort, many others, all of us this week have been reporting Leon Lett. His suspension would probably be 6 to 8 games, but we just spoke with league officials a couple of moments ago. They said a final decision was made later on in this coming week, so we will know, and Dallas will know for sure. Still to come, they came in together in 1983. Jim shows us a different side of Dan Marino. And stress, a common thread between head coaches. But what are the dangers and how do they cope? Stay with us.
Benny Pesterverde hopes to continue his success of a year ago. Career year, 13-2 as a starter for the AFC East champs. And now with more on that game, here are Greg Gumbel and Phil Sims. Gentlemen.
All right, Jim, welcome once again to the Meadowlands. And oddly enough, no surprise whatsoever, one of the first Patriots to arrive here at the Meadowlands earlier today was quarterback Drew Bledsoe, the leader of this team. Last season, his season ended in frustration. He watched the last two regular season games and the postseason from the sidelines with a fractured right index finger on his throwing hand. Now, that has healed just fine. We expect a heck of a passing duel between Drew Bledsoe and Vinny Testaverde today. But there is another duel brewing, and that's out on the outside.
And it's not you and me, is it?
No, it's not.
No, it's Keyshawn Johnson against Ty Law.
one of the two teams that beat them last season, the Miami Dolphins. And earlier, we spoke with Denver head coach Mike Shanahan and asked him what most concerned him heading into the season opener.
Well, Miami's an excellent football team. They led the NFL last year with the fewest amount of points given up. They've got high expectations, and so do we. So, it's everything that you look for in the first game of the season. And with five preseason games, we're sure looking forward to this one Monday night.
Brian Griese starts. Now, let me ask you this. You win two straight Super Bowls. You've made a reputation on your entire career as being an offensive guru. And people are second-guessing this decision. Does that disturb you that the fans and the media could actually sit back and second-guess Mike Shanahan with your background and your record?
Well, I think that's part of the NFL. Everybody's got opinions, especially when it comes to the quarterback situation. But I feel very good about Brian Griese coming in and being the starter of our football team. I've been around him now for a year and a half. I like the way he handles himself. He's a very mature person. He's got a great feel for our system.
Hey, Coach, I want to look back on September the 1st. After you demoted Buddy, he had some rather stinging remarks about the demotion, about how he would come back to the Broncos. Here's what he said.
When I had a level head and I thought about it, I can't walk out on Romo and Ed McCaffrey and Brian and the guys and Coob, and I can't do it. I can't do it. Now, if it was a one-on-one card game and Mike dealt me that hand, probably do like they did back in the day. But that's not the case, and it's not about me and Mike, and it's about the team and the long road to try to preview.
So, Coach, you can look past those remarks. You can move on. You can put Brisker back into the game if needed.
Yeah, I really can. And I understand Bubby's frustration. I feel that Brian is the best guy suited to start the game. Now, that doesn't mean I don't have confidence in Bubby, because I do.
A lot of times, the best way to describe these jobs is just pressure cooker.
Absolutely, Stuart. I visited with about 20 NFL head coaches about the issue of stress in their profession. And the consensus was it's stronger today than ever. Impatient owners who have paid millions for franchises want to win now, so there's more coaching turnover. Consider that Dennis Green and Bill Cowher are the deans of NFL head coaches, and they've been with the same team for only 8 years. The pressure to win can be hazardous to your health, and for many head coaches, it just doesn't matter.
It's almost like every little move is scrutinized. I've seen this game chop guys up. I've seen guys get induced. You can't even believe it. If you take the game home with you, it'll kill you.
It hit me when I first went to New York, and I went into the dentist, and he said, Jim, you mind if I take a picture of you? And I said, Doc, I can give you pictures. You want a picture? I can sign one and send it over. He says, no, I want to take one today because I want to watch the aging process.
You're driving me nuts. You're driving me nuts.
They're stressing everything. You can say it's because of coaching, but it's not because of coaching as much as it's because of the personality of the person that creates the stress.
Perhaps the worst part of stress is that it's self-inflicted. People respond differently to the same stressors. Researchers place people into two categories: hot responders, like Mike Ditka, or cool responders, more like a Tony Dungy. The majority of NFL head coaches are hot responders, those who externalize their emotions.
Yes! No! That's a fourth down! He's fourth down!
Quick, baby in Dallas, make him win the game.
Concentrate! Go, you gotta make that play.
Although it's far from healthy, it's hard to argue with this combination of stress and success. Bill Parcells, 2 Super Bowl wins, 4 heart procedures. Mike Ditka, 1 Super Bowl ring, 3 heart procedures, and 1 in-season heart attack. And Dan Reeves, 4 Super Bowl appearances, 2 heart procedures, including an emergency quadruple bypass last December.
When someone came in and said something about Dan, I was sitting there with a bag of potato chips in my hand, and I said, I kind of threw that away and grabbed some water and said, I'm going to get down and work out. So, to me, those are the signs you better look at and say, listen, if you don't watch it, that could be you. You keep putting it off because you don't want to admit it. Because that makes you feel, weak. I got a heart problem, right? And it's so silly, because we take ourselves to be such macho guys, and, we can't be hurt. How could Iron Mike be hurt? but it's true, we are.
Doctors say chronic stress may be linked to heart disease, immune deficiency, even memory loss. While some coaches insist their jobs are no more taxing than other high-paying, high-profile positions, the reality is, during the course of a game, a coach's heart rate could actually be higher than it is during strenuous exercise, according to Dr. Charles Brown, who's Dan Reed's cardiologist.
The unique aspect of coaching versus another profession would most would be the game, because the intensity of that stress that, say, may be present throughout a normal businessman's working week is concentrated and amplified into one short segment of time.
At times, do I feel like my heart may stop? Yeah, I mean, I do. There's times when you feel like that above
it. I think everybody looks at it and says, you know, I need to check and make sure that I don't have the same symptoms that Dan has reported that you get the physical.
I've never been one to waste time on physical. And I am telling you the truth. I have no time for golf or physicals or any of those things.
Gunther Cunningham is the newest of the hot responders. When he was hired as Chiefs head coach in January, the club insisted he be contractually obligated to an annual physical.
If I die, I hope it's on a football field. And I mean that. I mean that from the bottom of my heart.
I guess I don't love anything quite that much where I'd say that's the way I want to die. I love my job. I enjoy it. Football's been great. But, again, it's just a small part of me and a small part of what I do.
I don't do anything else. This is what I do. And I love it intensely. And I think if I were to have a heart attack, I hope it's on the football field. And that's it.
I don't want to do that. No. I don't want to ever get caught up in that being that important. But I understand what he's saying.
If you're going to be the very best, you can't just do it halfway, and you can't just do it 40 hours a week. Now, if you have a total commitment on something, you're going to sacrifice in some other area.
Johnson's commitment to winning in his 34 years as a coach meant very little time for his family. But when his mother, Aileen, died last December, he began to realize what his single-mindedness had cost him, and he nearly resigned from the Dolphins.
I said at the time that I was going to pull back and I was going to spend more time with my family, but since that period of time, everything's the same. I go in the office every day, I do everything just like I've always done it, and so that I don't know that anything's changed, but at least I thought about spending more time with my family.
Can you understand that?
Yeah, because that's what his life is. I mean, that's the only thing he knows. That's the only way he knows how to coach. Is be there, hands-on, and be involved.
Many NFL head coaches live by the mantra, that which does not kill me makes me stronger. And they follow their proven formula for success, regardless of the ramifications.
I mean, you've been successful because you've done things a certain way. I think you're so scared if you don't do it that way. I mean, as long as I'm involved, I won't be as much a hands-on type guy as I've always been. If I wasn't involved in it, that would be more stressful to me. I think that would kill me quicker than me being in the game and doing what I love to do.
When Dan Reeves is on the sidelines today, he'll be taking beta blockers, medication which is standard therapy for heart disease patients. The intent is to slow the heart rate's response to physical and emotional stress. And Stuart, as we know, there is plenty of that on game day.
On game day and all week. Andrea, thank you very much. Marty, you know, you ask most coaches, what's your hobby?
Back here on Fox Football Field with Junior Seau once again. He's going to show us some of the tricks of the trade. But Chris Collinsworth busted his chops about his receiving ability. During the preseason against Kansas City, Junior Seau caught this pass, Chris.
He's wide open because nobody would ever cover a linebacker. He can't breathe it. Yes, he makes the catch, and now he is going to waste $5,000.
It's all for charity, JB. And I think Junior can't afford it. This is a defensive segment. Howie, take it away.
Yeah, one of the biggest misconceptions about Junior Seau, probably the most versatile defensive player in football, you know, all due respect to Woods and all due respect to Deion Sanders, this guy can do it all, is the fact that you are perceived as being kind of a freelance player. Running
out off the play. Freelancer. No discipline. Does whatever he wants to do. Tasmanian devil.
When in fact there's a method to your madness. Talk a little bit about how your defense is set up. You're like a quarterback at linebacker audibling the defense.
Howie, and what you have to do, you have to be in the league long enough to kind of just state your case. And obviously I've been blessed to be able to do that. Coach Pasquale has the confidence in me to make adjustments as we roll. And if I see something that will help the defense, I'm going to change it.
Now, one of the biggest parts of making you the player that you are is your defensive tackles and letting you run for the football. One block is a backside scoop. Terry's going to be offensive guard. Chris Collinsworth, offensive tackle. They're trying to run away from, get this, they're trying to run away from Junior on this play. Okay, that's a shot. Okay, Junior needs to flow to the ball. Chris and Terry are responsible for me and Junior.
Don't worry, it's all half speed, baby.
Half speed.
All
right.
Now he's parked right behind a big old huge rear end. Oh, here he goes.
There he goes.
Don't flinch. Okay, go. Now I'm responsible for keeping these two guys off of Junior. Junior flows, he makes the play, and let's talk a little bit about the unselfish play of your defensive tackle. Unlike a lot of defensive tackles that do this in this situation, backside scoop.
Swimmers.
Let that swimmers.
Not the swimmers.
Guys that are looking for sacks.
Yes, and what we have is Norman Hand, John Perella, who are role players.
Create a quarterback class. You guys are the most celebrated ever. Dan Marino, the last one standing. You with him. Is he still as feisty as he's always been?
He is, and he's always been that way. I mean, ever since I've known him. I spent a lot of time with Dan in 17 years, and I asked him some off-the-wall questions. Yes, he seems focused and seems loose. Only the way a great quarterback should.
The Dolphins select quarterback Dan Marino of Pittsburgh.
If you were a rookie, Jen, what would your signing bonus be?
yeah, I don't know. Let's see. What did these guys get?
A lot.
They got a lot.
10. The linemen are getting 10.
Yeah. 50.
You're worth $50 million signing bonus?
Sure.
Your favorite place to play besides Joe Rogers, and why?
I can't say the Orange Bowl, right?
Tough questions.
Okay,
tough answers.
But I have to go with the teams in the AFC East because I've played there so many times, you know, like Rich Stadium or, you know, the Meadowlands, playing against the...
If you were a defensive lineman, and you had a break to the quarterback, Scott Free. What quarterback would you like to sack?
Oh, that's a tough one. I don't know, maybe Brett Favre.
Go! 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 And why?
Because he's, you know, he's mobile, so that would mean I'd be pretty quick. And
well, we know that's not the case with your head.
Plus, he's kind of a knucklehead, you know?
He's a good shot, Brett. Now that Bernie Kosar and myself have retired from the game of football, do you feel that now, for sure, you are the slowest quarterback?
Oh, I was much faster than you.
Oh, yeah, right. Oh, come on.
We could go outside and race right now if you want.
Any quarterback sneaks over the top this year?
If I have to do it, I will.
You do have some vertical, don't you?
No, I don't know about over the top. I'm just going to me.
Over the top? I saw you play hoops. You can get up.
I used to be able to dunk.
If and when the Dolphins win the Super Bowl, and for a former Bills player, it's tough to say that. Jimmy Johnson's hair. Do you break out the razors and completely shave his head?
I think I would. Sure, why not?
No
you can
problem.
Help me? You
nope.
Can help me?
I'll be right there.
Okay.
No problem.
Let's do it.
Imagine Jimmy Johnson with no hair.
I'm sure to win the Super Bowl, he wouldn't mind.
What has been the best thing a coach has told you?
Best thing a coach ever told me was Jackie Sherrill told me never to let anybody tell you how to throw the football. Because you're doing it just perfect. That was the best advice I ever got.
Oh, that's hey. Funny, Dan.
All right, we had fun. We had a lot of fun.
Stupid too,
hey. Stupid man.
Hey, Dan, you guys were righties, you know. You guys are right-handed quarterbacks. That's one thing. Consider the world of left-handed quarterbacks, all right? Steve Young gets set to battle with fellow portsider Mark Brunell. Now, they have it tough.
The whole world's set up so that lefties have to fight for what they get. Makes you tougher, meaner, and more determined.
He gets to the 10, across the 10 to the first down.
Physically and mentally, the last three games. What are we going to do about it? All right. Coach, your thought on that game today, Jets Patriots.
Well, one thing they can do about it, I think really Keyshawn Johnson's in for a shot. Keyshawn will no longer see the zones. Every defensive coordinator I talked to said, no man-to-man on Wayne Corbett. He'll make a highlight reel out of you. So what's going to change is full press bump and run on Keyshawn. I don't know if he can get away and beat the man-to-man. He's got to do that for 6 weeks.
Yeah, you talk about that trader board, though. Bill Parcells, that's the number one name on that board right there, and that's the difference in this matchup.
I know how well you know Bill Parcells. You guys go way back.
You go back to college days. You know, you go back to when you were at Georgia Tech. Bill was at Florida State. You both were coordinators going against one another.
Yeah, we had fun.
There you are.
Wow.
There you are. And you both went on to prosper as NFL head coaches. Between you,
you won two Super Bowls.
Well, and not only that, if you look at Bill's hair, his has changed. Mine's the same. It's the same piece I've had all these years.
You guys were wearing white coaching shoes, weren't you?
Oh, absolutely.
That was a wise guy look, wasn't
it? That was serious.
Guys, up next, we're going to walk the dog in Cleveland where football returns. Football is back when the NFL Today continues right after this.
He's a lefty, cannot be said without saying he's a crafty lefty. Three of the greatest pitchers from the port side ever were called lefty. Lefty Grove, Lefty Gomez, and Lefty, Steve Carlton. So down the middle of the road, that he lives in a mountainside bunker with food for about 2 months just in case in Durango, Colorado, or outside of there. And what about football lefty Bobby Douglas? Well, he was such a good passer, he's remembered only for his running. But lately, left-handed quarterbacks have been as good as they get. Two on center stage in Jacksonville today will attest. Steve Young of the Niners, Mark Brunell of the Jaguars. Here's Sean Salisbury.
We make the decision when we're young. Children in our athletic infancy, discovering what feels natural, completing passes in a friendly game of catch with our right hand, or going against the norm and throwing with our left. At the tender age of two, there was no doubt what felt right to Mark Brunell.
I was born left-handed, and so for me, there's never been any difficulty in deciding which hand to throw with.
Indecision and conflict almost marred Steve Young's athletic maturation.
My dad tried to make me right-handed. He begged me. He's like, he used to tie my hand behind my back, try to make me right-handed. Yeah, because he really didn't want a left-handed son back then. Being lefty was kind of not right.
Lefties are a minority in life and in sport. 10% of the world's population is left-handed, and only three of the league's 31 teams start southpaws. The fraternity of left-handed quarterbacks is minute. Hence, the myths still preside.
Just in real world, I mean, they're just different.
The way they eat, the way they hold a fork, the way they hold a pencil, you know, It's very unusual, and it just doesn't look very comfortable.
Probably some of the myths that were oddballs, a little different inside in the head. That's not true. I think we're pretty normal. I'm not quirky like a kicker, but I mean, I have my
pretty
quirks.
Close?
No. Nobody's close to a kicker. But a lefty, you know, you end up, you're a little bit nonconformist. You're a little bit unconventional. Growing up in school, all the desks are righty. So you end up, you know, trying to do your thing lefty, all crooked and backwards. The whole world's set up so that lefties have to fight for what they get. Makes you tougher, meaner, and more determined.
The uncommon takes time to become customary for first-time teammates of a left-handed quarterback.
Just the flight of the ball. You know, if you're running a goal on the left-hand side, the ball has the tendency to tail to the left side. You know, that different spin, it was very difficult for me to adjust to, and I feel a little more comfortable with it now, and knowing that the ball is gonna come in a little weird.
The problem with most balls is that they're made for righties, because righties deal.
You saying balls are made for righties now?
Yeah, right. And so another thing a lefty has to overcome.
Is that a conspiracy theory?
It's not a theory. It is conspiracy fact that most balls are right-handed. And so whenever you find a left-handed ball, it is beautiful. That thing flies.
Lefties do have heroes they can idolize. For instance, the last three U.S. presidents were left-handed. Albert Einstein was lefty also.
Einstein, they said that, you know, when he was a kid, that, you know, that he wasn't very smart. No one gave him a chance of doing anything in the world. How about George Washington was probably lefty? I can see him in the front of the boat when he's holding the thing. He's holding a lefty.
I mean, maybe why they're so smart, they're doing things backwards, I guess.
Just flip it, you know? As a righty would do it, flip it, and you can do it lefty. And I feel bad for any kid out there that just can't be himself. You know, if he's lefty, man, let him be.
I never knew that the silver dollar across the Potomac was a left-handed scud.
That's very interesting.
Next, our pick for Super Bowl 34. Who will be going to Atlanta? We give ours in a moment.
out and says, hey, we have a chance to put this team together and be good early. They got a great management team. They've got, I think, a dynamite young quarterback, and when Couch comes along, this is a good ball club.
Carolina won 7 games in their first year. That's the expansion record. I look for them to at least equal that. I think they can win 7 games. Good lines on both sides of the ball. Yeah.
What I think is important for the Browns fans is not necessarily win a lot of football games, but play hard-nosed, tough football. Get it. If you lose, at least you're smacking people. That's what Cleveland wants.
Hey, Randy, real quick. Detroit at Seattle. Joey Galloway said today he's prepared to sit out the whole season.
He's getting bad advice and making bad decisions. Don't challenge Mike Holmgren now. Talk to people close to that situation. You better get back and play some football.
All right, guys. It's game time. Coming up next, we're going to send you out there. Thanks for being with us on the NFL Today. How did you enjoy it? Did you have fun?
Yes.
What should I ask? We'll be back.
Come on, guys.
Enjoy the game.
I can't believe you asked that guy.
I'm having a good time. I just want to know if our friend here has ever done any time in a real dog pound.
That's just the thing. It's no big deal.
Yeah. Save it for the Humane Society, you poser.
It's the Steelers against the Browns on ESPN Sunday Night Football. It all begins at NFL primetime at 7:30.
Jimmy, head with hair. Long, beautiful hair. Shining, gleaming, swinging, black and white. A home for fleas, yeah. A hive for bees. A nest for birds, ain't no word for the beauty, the splendor, the wonder of my hair. Blow it up, show it up.
Well, each week on Sunday NFL Countdown, we give you something to get ready for. But, I mean, let's just forget to get ready. Let's just get ready for Atlanta. Super Bowl picks. We've been at this a while. What do you like, Tom?
Jacksonville, the right team and the right schedule. And Green Bay and Brett Favre with a full supporting cast. I think Jacksonville, Green Bay.
Jim?
You got to have the full package. I'm going with the Minnesota Vikings and the Jaguars.
Mm. Sterling?
I'm going with the Pro Bowl coaches. I'm going with Minnesota and the New York Jets.
I picked Jacksonville and Green Bay before Tommy did, and he knows it, so it's all about Brett Favre. He gets it done.
Well, what about Coach?
I'm going to make it 3. Green Bay, Jacksonville Jaguars.
Stu.
Got to go with the Jets and Vikings, and the Vikes will score their 60 points in the Super Bowl game.
I've thought a lot about this. I really put a lot of extras. A lot. I've looked at all the charts and everything else. San Francisco and Buffalo. It's the last year of the millennium. I'm not getting off that now. We'll be back to wrap it up in a moment. See you at the Super Bowl.
So what you're saying is you can't change your oil every 3,000 miles because you're too busy.
Thanks for the NFL's. The Cleveland Browns, after a 3-year hiatus, return to Cleveland. That's their game at 8:15 against their arch rival Steelers. But what an opener. Week 1 in the NFL. Comeback, we got them. On NFL primetime, the road to the Super Bowl begins today. Which rookie will make his mark, Ricky or Edgerrin? An NFC Championship rematch. Will Moss grow or will the Dirty Birds fly high again? Can the TaylorMade Jags be finer than the Niners? J-E-T-S, jet. First test, painful. Washington tries to skin Troy and the boys. Can Favre and his pack avoid an Oakland raid in Week 1? Upsets in the making. Big time finishes. You think you know what's going to happen? That's why they play the game. Well there, and welcome to week one of the 1999 season, the final year of the decade, the final year of the century, the final year of the millennium. I'm Chris Berman. This is Tom Jackson, NFL President Tommy. Talk about coming out of the gate. Some of these heart stoppers in the fourth quarter and some of the plots remain the same.
Well, for a week one, a very telling week one, we found out something about the teams that are used to winning, the teams that are used to losing.
And no pun intended, some bad breaks.
Yeah, some big losses,
at least one team in particular hoping to head to the Super Bowl. But we have 13 TVs, as Art Donovan once said, 13 afternoon games. Here we go. We start in the land of the cheesesteak. For Andy Reid and the new-look Philadelphia Eagles, they had a horrible offense last year. Jake Plummer. Jake the Snake and the Cards made the playoffs last year, but his thumb contributed to three picks in the first half. That one picked off by Brian Dawkins. And Andy Reid trying to shake things up offensively.
Well, offensive coach minded, and you watch him. This is trips down to the lower part of the screen. He backs the tight end off. Luther Broughton changes it into slot double wing. Works the screen to the top. Luther Broughton, their tight end screen, gets into the end zone for a 15-yard touchdown.
Tommy, now the Eagles lead at 24-6 at the half. Last year, they had 161 points all year. That means they've already scored in a half more than an eighth of last year's points. But Jake the Snake Plummer can come back. Rob Moore, just back in a few days ago, who needs practice, 46 yards on the play. Two plays later, Plummer, Moore, touchdown. The Eagles lead is down to 24-22. 2 minutes to play. Eagles are the third and four. Peterson for Brian Finneran. And actually, they almost can let the clock tick out, except he fumbles it into the air. And the Swami's cousin, Kwame Lassiter, picks it out of the air. 31 yards, and the Cards have a shot. 100 minutes to go. Plummer. He can do this, Tom, the naked bootleg.
Well, Jake Plummer has the speed to get around the corner. And I love the fact he doesn't go out of bounds. You have to knock him out of bounds.
Chris Jackie. He just squeezes one through for the winning field goal. And so a 24-6 deficit is turned into a 25-24 Arizona Cardinal opening day win on the road, despite the fact the Eagles, for them, had an offensive explosion. The Cards had lost seven straight opening games until the day. But Plummer, 25-49 for 274. He's excited.
And what a typical Jake Plummer day. Those three INTs in the first half, none in the second half.
Deuce Staley at 100 yards for the Eagles, who will be better. But they got a way to go as they threw for less than 100 yards to their quarterback. Panthers at the Saints. Ricky Williams' first NFL game as they had the hero welcome. But on the opening kickoff, Michael Bates returns for Carolina. And boom! Fumble! Fred Weary with the hit. Tyrone Drakeford picks it up. 20 yards. 7-0 Saints. The first challenge of the season. The new replay rule, Mike Ditka says, this play that Billy Joe Hobert pump fakes, and then they originally called a fumble, which would have been an 8-yard loss for the Saints. Now, what are they doing here, Tom? Is this third world election, or did they put a quarter in that to look at a peep show? I mean, what is that? It just doesn't seem right. At any rate, they rule it was an incomplete pass, so it's 3rd and 10. Final, second, first quarter, Ricky Williams, tackled by Eric Davis. Williams hurts his ankle. He did return for two series. Again, we've seen this.
Yeah, Ricky Williams with some injury problems early, and I think it had to do with the rep in camp.
10 carries, 40 yards for Ricky. Steve Berline, big hit by Wayne Martin. 19-10 Saints, fourth quarter. Berline, Brady Smith, and LaHua Glover meet at the quarterback. 7 sacks, 7 hurries, 10 knockdowns, 1 interception. Steve Berline seen stuff like this before, and the Saints win it by the count of 19-10, and they do have a good defense. The Ricky Williams, now they never heard first preseason game out. Now who knows, although X-rays are negative on him.
I mentioned the reps or lack of that he got during the camp period. 9 carries during training camp, 10 today. That is approximately, since he joined this team, 3 per month. It's not enough to get yourself honed into playing in the NFL.
So Ricky Williams, this injury a little lower on his ankle than the preseason injury. When we return, the Titans, new look, new name, same running back, Eddie George, wild one with the Bengals, and the Rams, quarterback named Kurt Warner. Could the Ravens close them to make it nevermore? We'll be back. What a night we're going to have in Cleveland. The Steelers and the Browns. Ty Detmer will get the start in 72,000-plus throng at Cleveland Browns Stadium. A new helmet, a new name, a new home. 4 years, 4 homes, and 2 names. More than 2 names. And there is the Tennessee Titans now at Adelphia Coliseum. But Jeff Flake to Willie's Jackson. And Bruce Cousins, Bengals, a trail 26-7. They lead 29-26. Jeff Blake ran for almost 100 yards, often had leg cramps. He had to go in and out. Akili Smith played a little bit, and he fumbled from center, 1 for 2 for 11 yards. Tom, 35-26, the Titans trailing. Steve McNair to Eddie George.
Yeah, and a lot more aggressive, throwing the ball down the football field and throwing aggressively, even with his short passes, Steve McNair.
So Jeff Fisher and the Titans trail 35-33 after the extra point. 12 seconds to go. Still, same score. Al Del Greco, Houston Oilers. Tennessee playing in Memphis, in Nashville. And now it's the Titans. It's good. He now has over 300 field goals for his career. And wow, what a big comeback for the Bengals. Spoiled as Tennessee wins a wild one. We don't really have time to show you how wild this game was. 36-35, Steve McNair throwing for 341 yards. Jeff Blake actually running for 90 yards.
Yeah, one of the best plays the Bengals had was Jeff Blake running out of the pocket. He got the leg cramps, unfortunately. But again, a great day for Steve McNair.
Well, the Bengals held Eddie George to 43 yards, but they couldn't get a win out of it. Laterals to Taj Allen, who Taj Mahal's his way down to the 41. Rams are going to score to make it 10-0.
Yeah, and John.
The Rams would seal the game up 20-10. Kurt Warner, not the guy that twice ran for 1,400 yards in the season with the Seahawks, but the guy from the Iowa Barnstormers of the Arena Football League. He's the starter with Trent Green gone for the year. Hits Torrey Holt, the rookie. You know what? Warner threw for 291 yards. Rams, why, that was Werewolves London Fletcher dancing around as the Rams beat the Ravens 27-10. It's Mitchell, who threw for only 188 yards in his debut for Brian Billy. When we return, new coaches to the Chiefs and Bears. Who would somersault afterwards? And Cowboys and Redskins have had some great ones, but I'll tell you what, for excitement, this one was right there. They head to overtime. We'll show you what happened. If you like offense, you'll love this. Barrett or the truth?
From Bristol University School of Football.
Chiefs at Bears at Soldier Field. First time two new head coaches debut against each other. That's Gunther Cunningham, Chief Dick Geron. I watched him run the football for Yale and Carm Koza back when he was at college. He's an excellent defensive back, now getting a shot. Shane Matthews' band is marching into the end zone. His first NFL start dumps to Curtis Enos. He's in there, and the Bears lead it 7-3. 10-3 second quarter. Cade McNown played a series. McNown, the rookie, to Macy Brooks, 23 yards. Hey, the Bears were fun today in offense. McNown, 6-for-9, 77 yards on his only series, 20-3 Bears at the half. Now, watch this play, Tom.
Well, boom, you look at the numbers coming at the young quarterback.
And this time, the Shane Matthews band is crashing. As Donnie Edwards picks up the Carroll-like play, goes 79 yards for the touchdown, 20-17. The Bears lead is down to 3. Under 3 minutes to go, Elvis Gerback overthrown. Elvis threw it too far out of the building. Gunther Cunningham of Loser and the Bears. And Dick Geron hired Gary Crowton from Louisiana Tech to really run a wax-style wild offense. 5 wideouts, reverses, shotguns, slants, dump off. These are the Bears. They won it 20-17. Congratulations to a good guy, Dick Geron. Cowboys, Redskins. Did not have Deion Sanders trying to work out before the game. Can't go. 14-10 Cowboys, second quarter. Steven Davis stripped by George Ice Teague. Always around the ball, Tom. 2 fumbles lost in the red zone early for North Turner. Third quarter, 21-14 Skins. So Dallas led 14-3. Skins don't have the lead. Look at Steven Davis.
What a great stiff arm on that same George Teague around the football, and did it without grabbing the face mask key, because he would have got a penalty if he had.
Michael Irvin sitting out a lot of third down plays. He wouldn't necessarily please, but I think he would be later. 28-14 Skins. Brad Johnson had a big day in his Washington debut. Albert Connell. Connell between defenders. Takes the ball away. 32 straight points for the Skins. 35-14.
Great job of concentration by Albert Connell. You see, he goes up, keeps his eyes right on the football, and then shows great strength, taking it away from the defenders, and great balance to get into the end zone.
So after 32 straight points, Tom, for the Redskins, Dallas has scored 7, under 4 minutes to go. First down, Aikman to Michael Irvin. He slides into the end zone. Call the touchdown, 35-28. Here come them Cowboys. Deion thrilled. 3rd and 7, but Irvin in with a 1:50 to go. Aikman, they ran this play the play before, no good. Now it's good. Touchdown, 12 yards, 35-34. Would Richie Cunningham provide happy days? Yeah, doinks it in. We're tied at 35 after the wild extra point. 18 seconds left, fourth quarter. Low snap for Brad Johnson. To Michael Westbrook, it's a flag on Kevin Mathis. Redskins, 42-yard field goal attempt to win the game for Brett Conway. Matt Turk, the snap from his brother to Conway, he twitties it. It's only make-believe. What's he going to do? We go to overtime. as the new slippery ball slipped through his hands. Emmitt Smith, it's a fumble deep inside his own 10. But the Cowboys recovered. Tom, 4 plays later, 3rd and 2, own 24. Look at the play action.
Yeah, and look at the play fake. You see Aikman hover over the football, drew the defense, head in the backfield.
Uh-oh, they were closer to the Rockets at Cape Kennedy than they were to covering Rocket Ishmael. 27 straight Dallas points to win it. 41-35 in overtime for the first time in his career. Troy Aikman had 5 touchdown passes. Aikman threw for 362. Brad Johnson threw for 382. 2 receivers on each team had a 100-yard day. A runner on each team had 100 yards. Each team had 500 yards in offense. And I know these may not be necessarily.
So there wasn't a lot of defense in this football game.
They're not good in a game played near the Pentagon, by the way. Tommy, the big name still delivered. Boy, crunch time Dallas, 21 points.
Well, Jimmy Johnson, Barry Switzer, Chan Gailey, and I think Chan Gailey does a great job of altering this offense and opening it up. But you still talk about the three guys. It's Troy Aikman, Emmitt Smith, and Michael Irvin. And I think last year we have to realize Michael Irvin caught 1 touchdown the entire year. He caught 2 touchdowns today. So if he can begin to become a weapon, again, for Troy Aikman, I think that this Dallas offense will be in good shape. But they still have a lot of questions defensively. I think they knew that going in.
I like what I see. Norv Turner in a vertical-type offense.
Yeah.
Really hadn't had those type of guys there, but he and Brad Johnson combined for a great game. But they need a horizontal
defense.
We're all going to be horizontal at the end of the year. What a wild game in the nation's capital. We go inside the numbers. Come back to the NFC East by Arizona and by Dallas, both on the road. You figured that the home teams had it made, but that's why they play the game.
Inside the Numbers is brought to you by Visa, the preferred card of the NFL. It's everywhere you want to be.
Patriots, Jets, Super Bowl 5. One of the newest gets Blaney Pommely trying to give the Jets a win. And staying in the toughest division of football, the AFC East, Edgerrin James. And he had the edge on, much to the chagrin of the Buffalo Bills. Colts Bills also coming up.
The Pittsburgh Steelers take on the brand new Cleveland Browns on ESPN Sunday Night Football.
Get your Browns.
What's your problem?
No one else is insulted by this guy?
Hey, take it easy.
What? I'm having a good time. I just want to know if our friend here has ever done any time in a real dog pound.
That's just...
The opponent tonight for the New York Cleveland Browns, fitting their arch rival, Cordell Stewart and the Pittsburgh Steelers. 8:15 Eastern, 5:15 on the West Coast. It shall be fun. Tuna Bowl 5, which the normally pessimistic New England sports fan figure out as an automatic loss. Even in the Boston Globe on Friday, quote, it doesn't look good. The Jets talking Super Bowl, the Patriots hoping to make the playoffs. Trouble? Well, since the game was played in the swamps of Jersey, starting with a Tuna Bowl, it was almost like the boss coming out and playing Badlands. I mean, that's one of those songs that, like, you go out of the garage in fourth gear. Pete Carroll, Bill Parcells, talking about places to go in Hartford, I guess, Tommy. Second quarter, 7-3 Jets, Drew Bledsoe. Deep for the speedster, Tony Simmons, 58 yards, 10-7 Jets. Now, on this Curtis Martin fumble, watch Vinny Testaverde. Just keep your eye on him. And he didn't do much, Tom.
Well, that's just a matter of that turf. You're backing up. You try to push off. And we all thought as we were sitting there watching it that it might be his Achilles.
Ruptured left Achilles, out for the season. Tom Tupa, not Rick Meyer quarterback, because Meyer is the emergency quarterback. You bring him in now, none of the other guys can play. So Tupa, the punter, on the first play. What a great call. Goes for a touchdown the first play after Vinny's hurt. 25 yards to Keyshawn Johnson. Jets at a safety, 16-10 at the half. First possession, Jets third quarter. Tupa, last the high holy days. Steve Israel on the blitz. It's a bumble, rumbling, bumbling, stumbling. Willie McGinnis played a great game. Falls on it. Touchdown, 17-16. Even.
Yeah, and we're going to take a look here at Willie McGinnis on 3 occasions and watch the burst that he has. The last 3 steps right there as he flashes in front of Tupa to force him to throw the ball away. Again, forcing him to throw the ball before he's ready. And here comes his second sack of the day. Look at those last 4 steps as he gets to the quarterback. That is a healthy Willie McGinnis, which we didn't see last year.
Well, the Jets were thrilled about their offensive line, but the Patriots coming under Pete Carroll. They've done that. Pats up 27-22. Now in the fourth quarter, you can bring your emergency guy in and play them all. Meyer, though, watches as it's a defensive player, Brian Cox, that provides the offense. Picks off Drew Bledsoe, 27 yards. They're up 28-27. Bill says go for 2. Meyer, the new tight end, Eric Green.
Oh,
a little hard, but it was there, and the Jets still lead just by one. Come back to haunt them. 3:38 to go. The Jets trying to run out the clock. It's time to pass again.
Yeah, they were passing the ball, and this is about the third in a number of passes that went over the middle of the football field into traffic.
Ty Law made the play, guarding Keyshawn Johnson and Chris Slade. Mama, we're all crazy now. He made the pick. Bledsoe, Terry Glenn on first down, 12 yards and another first. On third and six, Bledsoe, Troy Brown, and his banner renown. First down to Patriots. They work it deep to 7 seconds. Parcells watches. Carroll watches. Adam Vinatieri tries to kick the Patriots to a win. Good! It's good! The new K-ball didn't bother him. Good! And it's the first loss by Parcells to the Patriots since their very first meeting. Parcells has a Jet coach. He had won the next three, but the Patriots win it by the count of 30-28. A major, major win for them afterwards. And despite 8 catches for 194, Keyshawn not thrilled.
What can you do? There's nothing you can do. You can't do anything. There's nothing. We can't do. We couldn't throw. We throwing interceptions. It just, man.
Well, tough loss for the Jets and a big win for the Patriots. Of course, Vinny Testaverde, we'll talk more about this in a minute. To have him out now for the year, what a change of plot for the New York Jets in week number one. And you see Tupa and Meyer and Lucas behind, and maybe somebody else to be signed this week. Who knows, Zolak, whatever. But I'll tell you what, elsewhere in the division, Bills, Colts. You remember back to 1987 when Pete Rozelle was the commissioner?
Indianapolis Colts. Our first round selection, pick, linebacker, Cornelius Bennett from Alabama.
It's the longest holdout ever. 12 years later, Cornelius Bennett plays his first game for the Colts. So does Edgerrin James, except he's a little bit younger. Thurmel Thomas hurt on the first play of the game. X-rays to his rib are negative, but the Bills couldn't run. Yeah, Tommy's defense fights here on the Colts.
You're going to see E.G. Green, the safety Kurt Schultz comes up, gets his head looking in the backfield. E.G. Green on the flag route and into the end, and for a long game, not into the end zone.
Well, this is into the end zone. Edgerrin James, who for a while was, what, 9 carries for 7 yards, but including that touchdown, Colts up 7-0. Now 14-6 Colts second half for Jim Mora. And Edgerrin James says, you know what, I think we're going to give you a head of steam now. And, boy, he looked better and better as the game wore on. 26 carries, 112. Welcome to the NFL, Edgerrin James. Oh, by the way, Peyton Manning was great last year. Marvin Harrison, touchdown, they had two.
Yeah, and you saw the great play action to Edgerrin James, and that's going to be the combination.
Well, here is Doug Flutie to Andre Reed, who moves past Paul Warfield and Lance Allworth. 6 all-time touchdowns. Congratulations to a great guy. He's had a great career, Andre Reed. Bills still in it, down 10-24, 14, 4 minutes to go until it's picked off by Tony Blevins. I don't think Hicks or Fien is going to catch him. Kevin Williams is going to try. He could go all the way. What? Touchdown! Touchdown! Wade Phillips tried an appeal. They got to go back to that ugly gray sweater, I think, Tom, because Indianapolis just throttled the Bills 31-14. Buffalo ran for only 47 yards. Peyton Manning on the day, although Flutie had 300. Peyton had 284. Frankly, in this game, Tom, the Colts won the battle of both lines of scrimmage. Yeah. Now, in the AFC East, number 5 last year, Indy, number 4 last year, New England, both winning key games against teams ahead of them in the standings, Buffalo and the Jets.
And you're talking about a division that had 4 playoff teams from last year. I think that every team understands what happened to the New York Jets today in terms of injuries. You include the loss of Wayne Krabbett before the season could even start. You've got Bill Parcells in a very difficult spot right now. The New England Patriots offensively, outstanding number of weapons in the passing game, which will cover some of their weaknesses in the running game if Drew Bledsoe can throw the ball the way he did today. The Buffalo Bills will not panic, although there is a possibility we start talking 0-2 next week. And then you look at I picked the surprise team again, the Indianapolis Colts. Mm-hmm. Edgerrin James is only going to get better. As he does, he's going to make Peyton Manning better, and Marvin Harrison has a chance to be one of those super receivers in this league.
Jets at Bills, the Sunday night game next week on ESPN. The loser is 0-2. Wow. The good news is, however, both teams 0-2. Actually, the Bills are 0-3 last year, and they made the playoffs. So we return Brett Favre, hurt but never fallen against the Raiders. Greg Hill, who needs Barry, right? As the Lions try to pull an upset at the Seahawks, and the Buccaneers say this is their year. Would Warwick and the Bucs get it well done against the Giants? Stay with us.
Raiders is a package. Don't play very often. Ray Rhodes
starts his tenure as head coach, the Green Bay Packers. Raiders lead 10-7 third quarter. Brett Favre constantly holding his thumb, Tom. It hit contact with Russell Maryland. He stayed in the game, but he played in pain throughout. But you know what? When you got Antonio Freeman, you got a heart like Favre, you do things like that and give him a 14-10 lead.
Yeah, and even though his hand was hurt, you could tell that he would not allow it to affect his throwing motion when he was actually delivering the ball.
Second and 15, next drive, Packers, Favre. But what is it, Jack Squirek? It's Katie Williams. Returns it down to the 5-yard line. Third pick against Favre. And the Raiders go on to John Gruden's team, leading 17-14 after three.
You're going to see a good job here of Rich Gannon reading the blitz by Sharper and getting Fred Vincent with James Jett, covering James Jett. The rookie gets beat by James Jett to get close to the goal line.
James Jett can go a long time, and the Raiders lead it 24-14 with 11 minutes to go. But Favre, they really like draft pick last year, Corey Bradford. Favre's third touchdown pass is 8 yards, makes it 24-21. You know, they're always ahead. That's why that 13 fourth quarter comeback, you think that would be higher. No timeout, a minute 51 to go. Favre comes to Dorsey Levin. Dorsey was a horse.
Yeah, and Dorsey Levin, back to a healthy Dorsey Levin, always get that extra 4 or 5 yards at the end of a run.
Favre for 46, ran for 78. Now Favre, well, what a dart to Bill Schrader. Down to the 20. In range for a field goal, which Favre spikes the ball, but then he goes to the corner for Bradford. Out of bounds with the one with 15 seconds to go. John Gruden, who used to work on the offensive staff when Favre was a rookie, knows what's going to happen. Favre, buying time, buying time, buying time. Jeff Thomason, touchdown, just 11 seconds to go. 11 play, 82 yards, no timeouts, under 2 minutes to go. That pack, win at Lambeau, 28-24, Favre's decision.